Hello, hello, everyone. Welcome back. I'm one of your co-hosts, Rico Borrego.
I am your other co-host, Tony Borrego.
And this is the podcast known as Relatively Sound, the podcast where nothing's for free. Today, Tony and I are finishing our album for album series for this month. Last week, we looked at my suggestion of the Treasury Hips album, Day for Night. And this week, we have Tony's suggestion. Tony, why don't you tell everyone what album we're going to be talking about today?
We are going to be talking about STP's third record, Tiny Music, Songs from the Vatican Gift Shop. I don't think anyone does the when they say it, but I like to do it. I think it's fun. But Rico, I gave it to you. I'm so excited for this. There has been a lot of heat building up in between us. This may be a very intense episode. So I gave you this album just right off the bat because I think it would make a good discussion. I think with Shangri-La-Di-Da, I gave you something that I really enjoyed that I think is, you know, not too 90s sounding. You know, it's a 2000s record, but I think it shows the band in a refined, well-balanced, you know, it's a, you know, I think it's a good rounded album. But it's very produced. It's a big critique from people. This one is all over the place. This one has a little bit, it's a sampler pack. It's got a little bit of everything. It is very rough around the edges. Totally different sound and approach and songwriting and production. Although still, friend of the podcast, Brendan O'Brien.
Yep, producer has not changed.
And this album came about during a rough time in the band's career. After Scott's first drug bust, album was made, tour ended shortly because of drug problems. And although it didn't get like the best, you know, reviews coming right off the bat, it is a fan favorite to my understanding. I believe Scott has said it's his favorite because of the versatility. I believe this is the record that Billy Corgan came out and said, like, made him change his mind on the band. And then praise Scott as being one of the greats of the 90s. There's a lot to talk about here. And I mean, I think that's all I need to say. I want to hear from you now.
Well, the first thing I want to preference is say that throughout our discussion, there might be some brief, or maybe more so the brief discussions on drug addiction, suicide and sexual assault. So if you don't want to hear about some of those topics, we're just warning you now, we're going to be getting into that a little bit just because those some of the songs are about. And as Tony said, this is my second Stone Temple Pilots album. Believe it or not, I've never heard, you know, Core or Purple, which I know are like their probably biggest albums, just probably by sales and hit singles and whatnot.
Every STP fan's probably mad at me that I gave you Shangri-La-Di-Da first and then this as a second. But
I mean, I still know singles from those albums, Interstate Love Song and Plush and Vaseline and stuff like that. So, you know, I think you made a smart decision by giving me
Shangri-La-Di-Da.
Yeah, I always, that doesn't roll off the tongue for me. But it was like a choice.
Does this album roll off the tongue?
No, this one doesn't either. But I mean, I just call it Tiny Music, so it's a lot better. But yeah, like that was a good choice for a first STP album for me. I did really enjoy it. I ended up buying it on vinyl, so that means that it, you know, got my stamp of approval. So you know, going into this one, I was hoping that I was going to, like, I mean, my hopes were that like the issues I had with that album would be resolved on this album, even though this one came before, you know, like, and so, my issues are mostly I really like the slower melodic songs, some of the ballads. Wasn't a huge fan of some of the rock songs, you know, like to me, like, you know, I mean, like, yeah, Days of the Week is a rock one, but it's kind of still like poppy. It's catchy. But like the opener, Dumb Love, and Hollywood Bitch, and Coma, and the closing song, Long Way Home. Like, all of those songs, some of them I like more than others, but like those ones just I don't go out of my way to listen to, where I will go out of my way to listen to like Black Again and Bipolar Bear and A Song for Sleeping. So, you know, like I was hoping there'd be like more songs like that on this album, or just something that would grip me more. I didn't have a too big problem with the production. You know, again, maybe just because, you know, a friend of the podcast, Brandon O'Brien, is a producer I'm familiar with, it wasn't a huge issue for me. We're going to go song for song, but I want to tell you, so we're going to be kind of begin with my very first listen, and I'm going to walk you through it because I think this is going to be important to when we go to song for song. That, and just because I think you're, for the last like 3 weeks, you've just been like dying to know my thoughts, and I think saying them kind of just out of the gate is good, and then we can really dissect each song. So first listen, and I'm gonna go back to these songs, but so let me just do my thing, and then we'll
okay.
We'll be able to talk for song to song. But like,
I will bite my tongue.
The album begins with Press Play, instrumental song. Totally not what I was expecting for an STP album, even though I was warned by you that this is a different album from them. But like, instrumental, it's kind of jammy. It's a little like jazzy. It's a little like it's weird. It's not a rock song. And like I said, it's like a jam because like it fades into like the band already playing. It's short. So it's kind of more like an intro song than like a full, like, you know, song with lyrics and full composition. So I was like, okay, this is a kind of a cool way. I'm like, if this is how the album's going to be, I think I'm going to enjoy this. And then, you know, you get to the next song, Pops Love Suicide. And I dig the song. And I'm like, this, I like this better than like Dumb Love. It's catchier. It's definitely got a hook in the chorus, but I wasn't like sold yet. I'm like, I like this, but if the whole album is full of songs like this, I will actually find it less impressive than the other album, because like, at least, you know, with the other album, you did have more of the melodic and there was more variety. I'm like, okay, if this is like one of the rock songs, cool. Then the next song, Tumble in the Rough, I'm like, okay, no, we're getting kind of back into that just like standard rock song where nothing really impresses me. And I was like, okay, this, and it's not a song I like dislike. And again, we're going to go back to each of these songs, so don't worry. But I was like, okay, we're kind of going downhill instead of like going up, especially after that cool intro with Press Play. Then we get the first, I don't know if it was the first single, but like one of the big singles from the album, Big Bang Baby. And I like it more than Tumble in the Rough, but I was still not sold. I was like, I like parts of this song. Like, I kind of like the chorus and I really love the bridge. And again, we're going to come back to these songs and I'll get more into them. But I was like, I'm not sold yet. Like, I'm like, this, and especially now that I know how you felt about Day for Night, that's how I was kind of feeling at this point in the album, where I was like, I'm wanting something different. I'm wanting something more.
And you like know it's there, but it hasn't clicked for you.
Well, I up to this point actually was not sure if it was there, because I was like, I'm like, we're already like four songs in, and my favorite song so far is like a small like interlude song, you know, instrumental. And like, that's not a great sign. Then we get Lady Picture Show, and I'm like, okay, this is where I want to be. This is great. This is like what I want. And then from there on out, a goddamn fantastic album. So what I'm going to say, because we're going to go back song for song, I'm not going to get too ahead of myself, but I'm going to say this, like, and even now, because that everything I just said was my first impression, like my first listen. But like, if my least favorite song, which I'm just going to say now, my least favorite is Tumble in the Rough, I don't hate that song. I just think compared to everything else, well, even on first listen, I didn't love it, but like, especially compared to everything else, it's just like a nothing song to me. But like, it's a kind of a slow start of an album to me, even though like you have some of the rock ones in the beginning and you have Big Bang Baby, which is like the big rock single. Like really the album picks up for me with Lady Picture Show and really doesn't falter from then till the very last song. So, and I'm going to say this too, and then we'll start going song for song. I like after my first week of listening to it, and I maybe had heard the album over 5 times, I went ahead and started looking for the vinyl online. And I was, my attention was going to actually buy it and have it ready for this episode. And I was going to pull it out right now and go, this is how much I liked this album. The problem is, it's only been repressed a couple times. And the most recent time was for the anniversary edition, which, yeah, it comes with a lot of bonus stuff, which I am going to get to later in this episode. But the problem is it's like $60. And I don't appreciate a lot of the bonus stuff that it came with, because the bonus stuff is mostly just on CDs. Like I think the vinyl only is of the normal studio album, which is, that's what I care about the most. I think I had to do some research, but like, cause the anniversary edition has like a live concert and then has almost like a demo version of every song. Every song has another version, whether it's a demo, instrumental, stuff like that. So
Even though they're not that different from the actual, you know, they're basically lesser versions.
I gave
them
a listen and for the most part, most of them don't sound that much different.
I mean, to me, the only tracks on the bonus really worth it are the instrumental version of Adhesive. There's like Eric's acoustic song and then like the full version of Press Play.
I disagree with one of those, but we're going to get to that. But so that's the only reason I didn't get it yet. I looked online and like some people are hoping that it's going to get, it's like the album is just going to get a basic repress in the future. So I'm kind of deciding if I want to hold out for that, because I really like this album. And I'm just going to say now, this album right now might be my favorite one you've given me. I might even like it more than I might like it more than Light Grenades.
Holy cow.
And we'll get into that by the end of the episode. I'm not even sure if I've decided that yet. So, but I like was going to have this on vinyl by the time we recorded this episode, but I just didn't pull the trigger. I think I will in the future, but.
In this whole spiel you're doing here, I've went through this range of emotions. I had this bolt of excitement. I had a few tears build up. Oh my gosh, that's such a relief. I feel like I can breathe now. Now that I know that you may be an STP fan now, maybe.
Yeah,
I mean, this is only one album of several, and their other albums don't sound like this, but this may be the foot in the door that you need.
So let's go back and work our way through the songs, okay?
Okay.
So let's go back to the beginning, the intro song, Press Play. Funny enough, like, you know, I did research on the album after a first couple listens. I don't like to try to research before I listen to the album. And then after like the second week, I started doing like research on Reddit to see like people's fans' opinions, you know, because I sometimes think those are more important than critics, you know, like the Billy Corgan stuff he said all that after Scott passed away. So it's like, I'm sure great. He said that. And it's great that he's like come around to the band, but it's like, whenever it's like after someone's passed away, it just feels less genuine, even though I'm sure he was genuine. But it's the fans' reactions that I care about most. Because at the end of the day, I am a fan. I'm a critic, but not like, I don't get paid to be a critic. So,
our armchair critic.
Exactly. Yeah. And a lot of people put this as their least favorite only because it is like the shortest song on the album, it's an instrumental. It's one of two instrumentals. This would not be last. I mean, I already kind of said what my least favorite was, but this isn't even bottom three for me, probably, because I think it's so cool. I mean, it's a bold way. If you're a, and I'm not even gonna call them grunge, because I know that's like a big debate, but like from being a rock band in the 90s. And having multiple albums before this where you're mostly rock, heavier rock, whatever label you want to call them, to begin an album with like this jazzy instrumental song is bold. And at the time, I could see a fan or especially a critic listening to this album and based off the first song going, oh, this is like their joke album. But
really?
Yeah, because it's because like, yeah, like imagine if like, you know, Pearl Jam's Vitology, instead of starting off with Last Exit, it started off with Bugs. Like,
well, here's the thing though. Here's the thing. The quality of Press Play transcends the joke. Well, I mean, I get it. It's called Press Play, so I'm sure it is, you know, a silly little thing. But I mean, the quality of that track is unreal. It is a very nice instrumental.
Yeah, and that was actually going to be my point, was that's the reason why I don't consider it one of my least favorites on the album, because it's like, you know, the bass line is groovy. I absolutely love like the vibe of what I assume is electric piano of some sort. Of some kind, right?
Brendan O'Brien does piano on it.
Yeah, which makes sense because he's done, I know he did a lot of piano work on like the No Code era Pearl Jam. Like, I think
Robert does the vibraphone, harpsichord. Sorry to shut you off. But did you know this, though? That Robert actually does the guitar in this song, and Dean does the bass for it.
Yeah, I think I did see that, which is cool. I actually think the bass is what drives the song. The bass and the keys drives the song for me. I also saw that, like, Scott has a writing credit because he actually did percussion on this. Like, the whole, this is, like, one of the few songs where the band has, like, full writing credits.
Right.
And there's no lyrics for Scott to write, so I feel like, yeah, he had to do the percussion. But I think, and the thing I wanted to point out too, and you and I talked about this yesterday, but if you are a Talking Heads fan and you know the song Seen and Not Seen off of Remain in Light, 49 seconds into that Talking Heads song, there's this like keyboard part that sounds a lot like a keyboard part in this song. It has the same like dun, 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 like the same kind of rhythm and almost like the same. I don't know if it's the exact same note, but and it's cool. Like I love Seeing and Not Seeing because of that one little moment in that song.
Right, it's the highlight of that song.
And there's I definitely don't think the Talking Heads is a band that they were going for on this album. There's a lot of other bands I think that STP tried to like were influenced by for this particular album. I don't think Talking Heads is one of them. So I think it was all coincidence, but I just noticed that and was like, oh yeah, that's cool. But yeah, I think like for this album, I think this is the perfect song to start the album with. And I did listen to the full version, which did come out with the anniversary edition of this album. And it's really cool. The full version's cool. I think it was the right move to just do like the, what is it, 49 seconds?
Something like a minute 20.
Or is it a minute 20? Oh, the 49 seconds. That was in my notes about Seen and Not Seen. Yeah, you're right.
Right.
My bad. But yeah, I think not releasing the 4 minute or whatever the long version is was the right move. Like, then it would have, and now if that would have been in the middle of the album, that would have been cool. But to begin an album with a like 3 or 4 minute instrumental like this would have been a little too out there, I think. So
I think it's a good length they chose. Like, enough. It's enough so it feels like substance, but not enough where it actually like affects the weight of the album, right?
Yeah. And yeah, I think, and I like you mentioned, it's cool that it's called Press Play because it's almost like they went into the recording process for this album with the intention of like, this is an album you're supposed to listen to front and back, which most bands always say that that's their intention when writing an album. But sometimes you listen to an album and you're like, even if all the songs are great, sometimes you can say like this, the flow, you know, doesn't flow. Like REM's Out of Time. I like actually most of the songs. There's only a couple that I don't love, but the flow is just, and it's because the songs are so weird. Like they're so different from one another, but the flow is just like, there's no flow almost. And that hurts the album. And this album, I don't think the flow is perfect, but I don't think there's anything I would like. I try to kind of rearrange it in my head, but every time I did not come up with a better way to arrange it. So I think it just comes down to, I think the beginning part of the album has the kind of weaker songs. And I don't think Press Play is one, but again, I'm giving more of a pass because it is less of a song than some of the others. So, you know, going into the first like real song on the album, Pops Love Suicide, on my first listen, like when the song first starts, I'm like, okay, this is more of a rocker. it is more like a Dumb Love type of opener where it's like, you know, this is like just a rock song, right? But it's way catchier. Like, yeah, it's a foot stomper, but like it's a little bit more polished than like Dumb Love. It's got like, I don't know, the guitars are not as...
It's more polished.
I think so. Yeah, it's not more polished than other songs on this album, but I find the song to be more like, I don't know, the production maybe is just smoother than on like Dumb Love. Like,
really?
Yeah,
really?
I don't know. And especially when you get into the chorus, like the chorus has a hook where Dumb Love, I can't even remember like the hook of that song right now. I can kind of remember the beginning guitar parts, but
yeah, like the hooks in Pops Love Suicide are great. Like I'm not denying the song. This is actually one that I really like a lot. Something cool about it is that the guitar and the bass and stuff is playing a riff that's in 6-4, but the vocals are doing a 4-4 thing. So it overlaps in a cool way, kind of like the original from If Not Now,
yeah,
When, where it's like it sounds normal and fine, but when you kind of break it down, there's something else going on.
Which of course I didn't pick up on. You know, but I hear it now that you say it. I'm like listening in my head and I'm like, yeah, you're right, the song is not in 4-4, not the music.
Something you have not mentioned yet, and I am absolutely shocked because I thought this is going to deter you from the album. This is your first real song with vocals on the record. Yeah. What do you think of Scott's performance?
The reason I haven't mentioned it yet is because the only song we've talked about in full was the instrumental.
Right. With Shangri-La-Di-Da, that is my favorite version of Scott. There's a good variety of sounds on there. I know the bands mentioned Number 4, that record, having Scott as one of his best vocal peaks as well. This album is the exact opposite, but I think the character is so strong. And I'm about to say something that you may agree with, may not agree with. I am kind of picking up Chester Bennington vibes in some of these songs, his vocal performance.
Okay, well,
Pops Love Suicide included. Sit on it. It's kind of that nasal abrasive thing.
Yeah, it's just so hard because obviously Chester Bennington of Linkin Park ended up being the vocalist for STP for a short period of time. So it's hard to make comparisons because there is comparisons just for the fact that he was a member of the band for a short time. Well, I'll say this as a whole on the whole album. Are there times where I think his voice is not as good as it could have been? Yes. But for most of the songs, his voice, even if it's nasally or whiny or the production on it isn't great, somehow it fits most of the songs. And I will say my complaint, like, okay, on this song, yes, this is one of the songs where I think his vocals, they had to grow on me, especially the yeah part during the, yeah. I don't know if it's like is it the post-chorus or is it the chorus? Like,
I would say it's like the bridge.
The bridge,
I really don't know. And then he starts doing the
yeah, yeah. Yeah. Like those, yeah, yeah. That I was a little bit like, I don't love this. But I'll say this, like what his vocals lack in tone, he makes up with a melody, because the melody of this song for the chorus where he says it's a love pop suicide and he like rolls it up, like that's fantastic. And that to me is the hook and what made the song so catchy for me. So, yeah, and I will mention, like, I'll mention in which songs, like I have it in pretty much in my notes for every song. Like, yeah, this song vocally, some of it too was the production, like on this song, like I feel like something could have been done to his vocals in post where it could have made him sound a little bit more fleshed out, a little fuller. I don't know. Like even the chorus, like it's great melody, but it's like, it almost at times from the song seems like it was like a rough vocal take. And like, maybe he was supposed to record another, you know?
Well, I will say when I first saw the anniversary thing come out, and it was like early version for like all the songs, I'm like, how Pops Love Suicide sounds like an early version already.
Already,
it doesn't seem like like, how do you get earlier, more demo-y than the actual song itself? I don't know, but I don't. Yeah, I will say the production on this record, I'm very curious to hear as we go through the songs. I will say this one, I think the production works really well, because even though everything sounds really thin, it somehow is really in your face. Like, I know something with like this album is like a lot of the guitar parts are recorded with like a smaller amp that's like turned up way loud and stuff, as opposed to like, you know, Dean's big, you know, rig normally. So, and also the bass mixing is kind of interesting. It's really upfront and it's not super deep. And I don't know. I think this song is a really good introduction to the album. Mine is Press Play.
Yeah, I do like this song a lot. It's kind of like, okay, I really love the chorus. I like the verses in the song, but it doesn't do as much for me. And same with the bridge, especially because of the yes that I don't love. I will say it has a great solo, kind of like near the... is there two solos? Is this the one that has like one in the bridge and one in the outro? Or is it just the outro? There's definitely a solo, and it's great.
Yeah, I think there is two. Yeah, you're right.
And it adds like the energy of the song, and the solo and the chorus reminds me of like kind of just like an old school rock song. This is one of the songs where like you kind of start getting a little bit into almost glam rock at times. This one I wouldn't say glam as much. I would almost say more like I don't know. I know you said like his voice, it reminded you of like Chester, but it almost reminded me of a less annoying Axl Rose. Like maybe it's just a melody, but I could hear Axl singing the chorus of this song, but it would not sound as good in his voice because he almost gets even whinier than Scott.
That is an interesting take. I like that though. That is cool. I'm going to think about that. You mentioned glam. I forgot to bring this up. Part of why I also gave this record is how well you like the Bowie record.
Yeah.
Bowie is huge influence on Scott, especially his solo career stuff. And this album does head more that psychedelic glam route at times. And I kind of wonder, Scott has covered Fame before. There's a Velvet Revolver song called Loving the Alien, which is a Bowie song. Do you think the title Pops Love Suicide could have been inspired from Rock and Roll Suicide?
It could have been. I didn't consider that. There are other moments on this album that I think there's more like specific Bowie references. But it could have been. I did kind of ponder what this song was about lyrically. And I do think on this album, to me, it's either the song has a very specific personal meaning or it's up for interpretation. And we're going to get into a song here pretty soon where Scott's got a record saying this is more of a stream of conscience type of songwriting. This one, I don't know, but like reading the lyrics, I kind of thought this was like his take on the pop star life. And, you know, like, again, the lyrics are a little kind of up for debate. And especially, like, I don't know, like I said, the verses don't hook me as much. I mean, there's some interesting lines where he sings Midwest farmers' kids are milk fed. I just feel like it's a take on society, but especially like pop culture and stardom.
The line mindless fools that aggravate it pick at you in desperation seems like he feels kind of like maybe victimized. That's kind of what I could pick up from this song, maybe.
Yeah, and in the outro he sings I'm in love suicide about a pop star homicide. So that does give me kind of some bow, because like I think in this song, it's one of those songs where like the song isn't about suicide.
Right.
Even though I didn't mention that in like our beginning like warning, but it that's not what like this song's about. So I definitely could see some Bowie influences. Overall, I think if you consider this like the first real song on the album, I do think it's a good one to set up the album, because it's not like you're putting the best song first. Well, sometimes I don't like that when an album does that, because if you put like what is the best song first, sometimes it almost feels like you're going downhill from there.
Right,
even if the
right.
rest of the songs are great. And there's some albums where that's okay. Like Narrow Stairs, Bixby Canyon Bridge is my favorite and I think it's the best, but there's so many other bangers after it that it's okay. But this isn't like not near the worst on this album. So I think it's a good kind of middle ground song to like start the album with. For example, if they would have started with the next song, Tumble in the Rough, I would have been a lot more disappointed, because Tumble in the Rough just does not do much for me. And I only just about an hour before we started filming this, I learned that this is the only song in the discography that Scott wrote all the music and lyrics for. So musically, even though like the guitar work and bass work is good, and obviously like he didn't write the drums and probably the bass part, but he like, I'm assuming he wrote the guitar progression.
Right.
It's just like, it gives me definitely more vibes of like Coma or Hollywood Bitch. Now I will say this, I like the tone of the song more than those two songs, but I think technicality wise, this song is not as impressive as those songs. And like I said, I don't even think those songs are super impressive. I don't love the guitar tone that starts the song with. I actually hate the guitar tone. Like, it sounds cheap, which I'm sure was done on purpose, but I don't love it. I do kind of like when the verses start, where the drums almost go into like almost seems like a double time feel, kind of.
Yeah, when he starts with the vocals.
The vocals, dun, yeah.
Dun, dun, dun.
And I will say the vocals are, I think, the best part of the song. This is one of those songs where he's not doing like his rock voice. It's more like lower in his range and it's clean. So I do like that about this song. And lyrically, I think it's a little bit more interesting maybe than even like Pop's Love Suicide, because like I read it like, me doing like just looking at the lyrics, I kind of wondered if this song was about him getting clean, and like maybe like, because like if you're looking at the title of the song, Tumble in the Rough, like, you know, because like the song starts off with him singing, I can't blank blank blank, I can't eat, I can't sleep, I can't live, I can't cry, and like he sings, so I can move, tumble in the rough, and that's the chorus. Well, I guess that's not the chorus, but like that's the title of the song. And like, to me, the pre-chorus where he's like, I'm looking for a new meditation, don't want any plastic validation, like I wonder if that's like when you go to certain like rehab places where you get tokens when you're clean for so many days, like I wonder if that was like a reference. And he even says in the pre-chorus, not looking for a new way to die. So like this song to me kind of seems like he's describing his chaotic life because of his addictions. But then in like the chorus, in the pre-chorus, he's looking to get clean. I mean, in the chorus, he sings, I made excuses for a million lies, but all I got was humble kidney pie, which I think is a funny line because it's the take on humble pie. But it's also him kind of like admitting that, like, okay, I've had all my excuses and they've got me nowhere. And he's even singing, so what? Like, what now? So there's a lot in the song that I actually do like. And we had mentioned earlier before the episode, the other line I like in the song, which is dead fish don't swim around in jealous tides. So the song has like all the markings to be a good song. I just think like the main guitar riff is just so, it seems very B-side to me.
I will say this. This is a song that I have mixed feelings about. I think everything you said is valid and I will respect it completely. It is the most musically bland song on the album. Yes, the production, although it is fitting for like almost like a, you know, like a beginner riff, like it does fit. It doesn't elevate the song. And I would, it's one of those songs where like every time, not every time, but I'll hear it sometimes, and just between like the simple riff and then him just saying, I can't eat, can't sleep, humble kidney pie, like, you know, steal your shoes so I can move. It just sounds so like kind of bullshitty. But then, yeah, when you unpack it, like we're doing right now, I'm like, oh, this is actually like well written. Like these are some of the best lyrics on the album.
I think it's better than it's not necessarily better than Popular Suicide, but I prefer it over that song because these lyrics just seem like there's more to unpack, where Pops Love Suicide is more vague.
Right. And you know what? This is kind of funny because this is actually seems to be one of the songs that they play regularly live, like a fan favorite type of thing.
Which makes
I'm not
sense
up to
because
date on the current
it's
STP tour,
easy.
but right. I mean, because it is like it's hard to hate, in my opinion.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I like it. I like it more, like, now that I'm talking about it, I probably actually do like it more than like Hollywood Bitch and Coma and Dumb Love, but it gives me more of that vibe than, you know, because like there's rock songs on that other STP album that I much prefer, like Days of the Week, Black Again. Because Black Again does have some kind of more rock parts.
Transmissions?
No, that wasn't one I loved. And even like there was other ones that like Regeneration had, that one had to grow on me
Well, I'm glad that one grew on you at least, because I thought
a
that
little
one
bit. I
never
mean, it's still
would.
not my like favorite, but it did grow on me. But yeah, like no, like Tumble in the Rough, it's a fine song, but I don't go back to it much.
Okay, so you said that you hit the guitar tone in the intro, right?
Yes.
How do you feel about it at the end, where it's the same thing, but how it transitions to the next track?
I don't like it. In fact, I wrote Don't love that ending with the bad tone and the abrupt nonstop. I mean, it's an abrupt stop, but it's like a nonstop because it just like it maybe just because it reminds me of the stupid malfunction on the vinyl for Coma, for the song Coma on that album, where the vinyl
That is
version
trauma.
flips the end, the outro. So that's what it reminded me of. So I don't know. I get it. It was done intentionally, but I didn't
Because
love it.
Big Bang Baby comes in so groovy after that.
Well, okay, and now that we're getting on to Big Bang Baby, this was a song I also had mixed feelings about, which is why I wanted to have an intro when we started talking about this album, because had I not done that intro and we just started song for song like we did last week for the hip album, you probably were going to think by the time we got to this song that I hated this album, because so far, like I had nice things to say about the last two songs, but I'm not like calling them 10 out of 10s. And this song, I'm kind of the same way with. Like, there's some things I like about it, and some things I don't. I think that the song is like super loud and kind of in your face, but it still has like a pop appeal, which I like. I really like the bass line in the song. I dig the guitars, but I don't like the kind of hand clap percussion sound. So something I like,
Like
something I
where at,
don't
for
like.
example?
Like just like the beginning of the song, like. When what?
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Well, I'm
Let
trying
it
to pull
out.
it up really quick because I just wanted to make sure what I'm saying is correct. So hold on, let me give it a small
I mean, for me, I
well
think I
like
actually
that.
really like the drum beat in this song. It's like a standout part to me. It's just a simple but good drum groove.
But there's
That's
okay,
why
if
I'm
you
like, what are you talking
listen,
about?
it's not the drum beat. I just like if you listen, there's hand claps panned to the right side. There's actual hand claps, and that's what I don't like. I find hand claps in most songs to be kind of cheesy. So it's a personal preference. I'm not saying the band did a bad thing by doing it. It's a very popular thing. Most band, I'm sure every band I listen to has one song with hand claps, but
You know, okay, I do
still love
hear
it.
it, and I do see that it doesn't really add that much, at least in my opinion. But I don't know, it's never really stuck out to me in the mix. So I'm kind of surprised that this is like an actual influencing factor to you.
It's a small one. I'm just saying, like, there's a lot of little things I dislike and like about this song. For example, I don't love this is the probably the other big song on the album where I don't love Scott's vocals.
Really?
Yeah. Like even in the verses, there's just they're not like even whiny. I don't know. I just don't love the tone, what he's going for. And maybe it's just the melody too. Like I'll say this, like the verses kind of with Pops Love Suicide, they don't do much for me. Now in the chorus, I like the song better because I do like, even though at first I thought it was gimmicky, the crash, 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 I ended up really liking that because it is catchy. It gets stuck in your head. Or even like the way he sings. Hold on, I need to pull up the lyrics. In the chorus, when he sings, I wanna cry, but I gotta laugh. Like, I ended up really liking that a lot.
Right, right.
But it had to grow on me. Like, I at first, I really didn't love... The only thing on first listen I loved about the song was what I considered the bridge, where they sing the nothings for free. I really enjoyed that. That, to me, is kind of the highlight of the song. I don't know why. I just like the chord progression they went with. I kind of like that when they sing that. It sounds like there's backing. It sounds like it's not just Scott. It's like multiple vocals, if I'm not wrong.
I just recall it just being another one of Scott, but I will say... If you haven't checked out the music video for this one, it may you appreciate it.
Okay,
it's like a low-budget video. Like, it's just them like wearing like kind of tacky clothes with like a white background. And at that Nothing for Freeze part, there's like this shot where there's like they're on like a television screen and there's like hearts around them, and they do like a whole little like Brady Bunch sort of gimmick where they're like looking at each other. Like,
oh, that sounds...
I don't know. It elevates the song for me, especially because the one downside of this song is it has the Chili Peppers effect. Even as catchy as the melody is, when you sing along to it, you feel kind of silly with the lyrics.
Well, so
not all of them, but
the lyrics. Actually, to me, it's kind of like Tumble and Rough, where I think there's actually some interesting things here. But so here's where the quote I read, where this was the song where Scott was like, he was, for this song specifically, he was doing a David Bowie stream of conscious type of songwriting. But I think there actually is like a narrative here. And I think it kind of, again, like Pops Love Suicide, I think this has to do with like fame. And specifically, I'm getting this song being kind of about Kurt Cobain. I don't know. I'm pretty sure this album came out after Kurt Cobain passed away.
I believe so.
But like in the pre-chorus, he sings, "There's a hole in your head," which I know that sounds pretty grotesque if he means that literally, but that would make sense. In the chorus, but then like in the chorus, when he sings, "Sell your soul and sign an autograph," I think that's just about fame in general.
Right.
And maybe the crash is like, you know, when you're a star and you fall and you have troubles. It's way the fall seems harder. If you're just an average day person and you have your problems, you know, it's okay. It's not as bad. But when you're in the spotlight, it's worse. So, yeah, I found the lyrics for the most part to be, you know, pretty interesting. You know, in the bridge, nothing's for free. Like, I don't know. Like, I think there's some imagery in the song that actually, even though some of the lines, like you said, kind of seem maybe throwaway, like, I do think there's you know, points in the song where I think the lyrics are actually pretty good.
And for me, I think that's why I do like Scott's vocal on this track, is because he sings it like between like this kind of like low, not, it's not a swagger, but it's, you know, it's like this, I don't know, he goes from kind of this talking little thing into like this really like screaming type vocal in like the chorus, where it sounds like his throat's just ripping apart. And I like the chaos in that, you know, chaos and the quirk go hand in hand.
And I will say again, this song's like a like dislike thing. I don't love the tone of his voice in the chorus, so kind of the opposite of what you said, but I like the panning that's done and the production on his voice in the chorus, especially with like the crash. Like, I think Brendan O'Brien is doing some interesting things with a lot of these songs that, even if the mixing and engineering part isn't great, you know, and I know this was before the Loudness Wars, so like, yeah, Shangri-La-Di-Da, like that is Loudness Wars. But on this album, yes, maybe like you were talking about, sometimes the bass seems like it's mixed a little weird, but there are a lot of production things I do like going on in this album. But yeah, like overall, the song is like, I could see why it was a single. I can see why it was, you know, a successful single for them. It's not like my favorite song. It's kind of Pops Love Suicide. It's not my favorite, but it's not my least favorite. It's not like Tumble in the Rough, where it's like when it comes on the track list when I'm listening to the album, I do get enjoyment from it. But I'd be lying if I thought it was like super impactful or super deep, even though I do think there is some depth to the lyrics. But once we hit Lady Picture Show, this is like where the album clicks for me. And like when I was first listening to this album and this song came on, after the song finished, I'm like, oh, there's my favorite song. Like, there's not going to be a song that tops that. Like, that's going to be my favorite. And maybe that's because I wrongly set the bar too low after the first, like, you know, three songs. But, like, you know, Lady Picture Show, this is the song where I think you get the most Bowie-like.
The most Bowie-like. Okay.
Musically, this song reminds... Well, first of all, the title reminds me of Lady Stardust.
Okay.
But musically, not the actual like notes or chord progressions, but the like the feeling that the song gives me reminds me of Ziggy Stardust, like the song Ziggy Stardust. Because when we did that, when we talked about that song, it gave me like a nostalgic classic rock vibe that I really dug, and that's what this song does. I absolutely love the bass in the song, and I think this is one of those moments where you said the bass is mixed really loud, where it almost acts as like the lead work.
Well, the guitar is like completely hard panned in the beginning.
Yeah, to the right. Yeah, exactly.
Because it doesn't stay like that the whole song, and it just makes me wonder. I just want to know, why did they decide to do that? Like not that it affects it negatively, but I don't know. It's just kind of like,
it's their experimental album. And oh man, if I end up giving you a couple Spoon albums, there's a Spoon song on one of their albums where the drums are hard panned to the left. All the drums.
Like completely.
Where if you take your headphones out, your left headphones out, you barely hear any percussion.
Jesus.
But it's on one of their poppy songs on the album where if that song had standard pop rock production, it could have been like a top single for them. But because the production is so weird, I don't think it did well on the charts, because I think it was released as a single. But no, I like the production a lot. I mean, I think at first I was like more, oh, this is interesting and this is good. But the more I listened to the song, the more I just loved how like the bass line was like the star of the show. I like how melodic it is. The actual chord progression, the specific chord progression, like, is, it's not, it's kind of one of those, what's the word I'm looking for? It's bittersweet. It's a little melancholy where it kind of sounds happy, but it kind of sounds sad. I will say the worst part about the song for me is that when I read what the lyrics were about, it totally was not what I thought the song was about. And the lyrics aren't bad. I'm just going to say this. The lyrics, without like going too much into like graphic detail, the lyrics are about this lady who was sexually assaulted and then like falls in love and then has to kind of deal with, you know, what happened to her and the fallout and stuff like that. And it just made the song way more on the bitter, sad side than on the sweet side, if you get what I'm saying.
Right. It got the sex type thing treatment.
Which I don't really know what that song's about, but I'm sure one day I will, because I'm sure one day you'll give me that album. But yeah, so it's like one of those songs where it's like, if you don't read, even when you read the lyrics, though, I wouldn't have thought that's what the song was about, but I read a specific quote from Scott where he's like, oh, this is what the song about. And I was like, oh, maybe this is one of those instances where you don't say exactly where you got like the idea for this, you know, like, not that it's based on like a real event, but like, I'm like, okay, I know, Scott, I know your mind was dark at times, but like, this is pretty dark for a song, you know?
Yeah. And I remember too, like I think Plush, like the story is that him and Eric were like in a hot tub writing lyrics for it. I hope this is not terribly inaccurate, but it also had to do with some sort of like murder or crime or something that happened. But for me, yeah, when I listen to the song, I kind of like, I know it's about that, but I just kind of choose not to even think about it. Okay. I did imagine you liking the song, but it's a song that I think some people really love, and I have always liked it, and I think it's one of those songs that has beautiful moments in it, but as a song, I never get excited for it. Like, for me,
oh, I do.
The standout bit is The bass has some cool kind of lines in there. The guitar solo is awesome. It's epic.
Well, we're going to get to that, but...
And one more thing, I'll let you take care of it, is, to me, I don't think Bowie for this song. I think Beatles.
Well, okay. And you mentioned this yesterday.
Which is off, close, you know.
Off after we finished the hip episode and we were chatting, we were I was trying not to show my cards too much, but you mentioned the song and you mentioned where in the chorus it gives you Beatle vibes, and it does, because it does that. Is it major to minor? Is that the thing that it does in the chorus? There's a chord change in the chorus. The little like walk down part, the little dun 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 dun, that part.
Right. It's very, just Beatles. Very typical, yeah.
It's a little bit of a cliche and stuff, but like it fits the song perfectly. It's very melodic. So I'll say this, like the chorus is kind of more Beatles, but I don't know, the verse is very Bowie to me. And I'm saying that as someone who's only ever heard one Bowie album, so I'm a fake.
I know you and
fraud.
I over here acting like we know everything about them.
We're frauds, but I love both sections of the songs. I love the verse. I love the chorus for different reasons. I like his vocals on the song. They're a little bit more refined.
Yeah.
They're in his sweet spot. But he still sounds playful. Like he doesn't tumble in the rough. Like, yeah, that's a good spot for his vocals, but it sounds like he's purposely trying not to go too crazy. Where this song, he still gets to hit certain notes and do little runs.
It's a little more agile than some of the other songs. The other songs kind of feel a little back and forth. Like, okay, we're in fourth gear, we're in first gear. Where this one, it feels like, here's my melody, here's my dynamics.
Yeah. And then, as you mentioned, the song has what I consider to be the best solo on the song. Because this album actually has quite a bit of solos. Not that every song has one. But this is, I'm not going to say it's my favorite guitar work, because there's other songs that has fantastic guitar work, but this song has my favorite solo. It sounds like a very old school rock solo. It sounds very thoughtful. And I love the tone of the guitar. I love the notes that, and remind me again, who's the guitarist? What's his name?
Dean DeLeo.
Yeah. He kills it on the solo. And I especially love the second half of the solo where Scott's vocals come back into the mix. Where he's doing a little thing. Like, I don't know how to describe it, because I'm not a lead guitarist, but the some of the phrasing he does during that second section of the solo is amazing. I love it.
Right. Like he does that pedaling thing where he like hits the top note over and over and then changes the note. And what I really like about Dean's work is that like he does a lot of like kind of like Jimmy Page type licks. So he'll come up with a really melodic line with some cool phrasing. And then kind of as like a signature closing note, he'll throw in like a bluesy lick, kind of like in Bipolar Bear is a great example. It starts off jazzier with some cool note choices, but then he ends it with just a straight rock lick. And I don't know, he does it in such a great, tasteful, as like a segue. It's cool stuff. I think it is a really triumphant solo.
Yeah. So, and then like, I forgot to mention this. I said my least favorite part was the lyrics. Besides that, my least favorite thing about the song is, and this is maybe more, well, I don't know if it's necessarily production, but there are some percussion noises throughout the song. I think maybe in the verses, or maybe it's in the chorus, that sound like reverby trash cans. I don't like that. That I would have not have included in the song.
Reverby trash cans.
Let me listen really quick to see where in the song it is. Hold on. You can talk.
I know this album has a lot of quirky elements and production choices, but I will say I think I've heard the album so many times that I'm just kind of immune to it.
It's in the chorus. He does like a tch, and then there's like a bang. After
he doesn't know his name.
Yeah, after that there's like a tch, tch, but the bang is like kind of in the background. I don't like that.
Okay, I do know what you're talking about now.
Kind
I do remember
like
hearing
a
this
gated
the other
reverb.
Day.
I don't love that.
Is it needed?
No.
Definitely not needed. Does it take away from the song or distract me?
No. I got used to it. Like you said, I got used to it. But I was like one thing I was like, okay, besides lyrics, this is the only thing I don't love about the song. But I love the way the song ends. I like that it ends with like that guitar slide and then Scott's like little falsetto. Like that part's really cool.
Yeah, and the ending chord, which they do at the end of, like, I think all the choruses, where they have like the tremolo on the guitar, and it's just like
very
a really moody
glam
chord.
tones. I wrote that on my notes. Yeah, it's just very like glammy, like. So,
like, yeah.
Yeah. So like I said, like my minor critiques of the song really aren't maybe not even valid because they don't bother me that much. Yeah, so like I listened to this song and when it was over, I'm like, yeah, this my favorite song on the album, nothing's gonna top it. And then we get And So I Know, and I finished that song and I'm like, nope, that's my favorite song on the album.
Yes,
And So I Know, that is actually my favorite song on the album. I stand corrected. It only took one song for me to be corrected, but I'm like, yeah. And So I Know is my favorite song on the album. This is like where the band lets loose and they're like, we're gonna do whatever the fuck we want. And this is like, we're gonna do this little like bossa nova jazzy song. Oh, that guitar riff is just like butter. And I love, people who don't know me, I love butter. I put butter on anything. Like, it's smooth. It's jazz with like the drums. It just has this like really nice like flow. But it's not like groovy, like a funk groove, but it's just like, it's almost like slow jazz, but like, it has that kind of bossa nova feel.
Right, is that the fast drums, but they're like,
yeah,
calm.
I love the tone of the guitar. You get like Scott's vocals are very smooth too. They're kind of like velvety, and I really like the keys. Maybe this is the vibraphone. Maybe.
Yeah, there is
yeah.
one on this song. I'm pretty dang sure.
I like that in the song. I just asked. The song has a lot of atmosphere. And maybe when I said the solo is my favorite solo, but it wasn't my favorite guitar work, maybe because this song has my favorite guitar work, I still like the solo more and Lady Picture Show, I think, more than the solo in this song. But the guitar work in the song is just super like refined, which I really like. The solo reminded me of something Brian Setzer would do.
Oh, interesting, interesting.
Like something like on like his that what was that one album that Mom and Dad had?
Well, you're talking about Sleepwalk, his version of it.
Yeah, specific. Yeah, but like there's other songs on that album where
the,
he gets.
Is it the Dirty Boogie? Is that what that album?
Yeah,
called?
That album. Yeah, there's. I mean, yeah, his version of Sleepwalk. That's what I'm thinking of. But there's other songs where his guitar tone is similar. So, my only critique about this song, and again, it's such a small critique that it doesn't take away too much, is I said I love Scott's vocals. I think this song lyrically, the lines seem just less important, not throwaway, but they don't impact me as much. And in fact, there's the one line I don't really love in the song where he sings Campfire Girls Make Me Feel All Right. I understand. I know where he's coming from, but when I think of like campfire girls, just those two words, I think of like Girl Scouts, which then gives the song like a bad vibe.
Right, right.
But I don't think that's what he was going for. And I like the way he sings it at the end. Again, everything about it I like, except like the line itself. I'm like, but and it's so specific though. Like there must have been like something he was referencing in his life, but because we don't know that, or at least I don't know that, it's like the song, I don't know, the lyrics don't stick with me. Even though I love actually the phrase, And So I Know, I think that's a cool song title. And it's a cool song. It's a cool line to base a song around. But yeah, and there's some cool lines like the disappearing floating grave. Like that's cool. But like there's not even that many lyrics in the song. Like a lot of them just kind of repeat. So,
and one of the lines is whirlwinds and roller coasters. But then
I don't like
he follows
I don't
it
mind that.
With what was it? The
long grass making shapes. Hello.
Yes, I like.
Yeah,
it starts off kind of like a BS line, but then he ends it with that, and then you're like, okay, he knows what he's doing.
I like that, but then it's like the campfire girls make me like that. I don't love. But again, I was like, I'm putting a weird context to it where I don't think there is one.
And
maybe
I
that's
totally
just because
see what you're saying.
Maybe that's just because the other day I bought Girl Scout cookies outside a grocery store.
Self sabotage.
Got to get those Thin Mints, but yeah. So like, but I mean, again, small critiques for the song. I think this song is like, And it definitely gives me those vibes of those songs from Shring La Di Da, where like what's the one after Black Again? Hello, It's Late. It gives me vibes of that song and a song for Sleeping, where like you have like the keyboards more in the song. There's more of an now Hello, It's Late has more of a moody atmosphere, where this one's very light and breezy and smooth, but they both have like atmospheres to them. And
right.
I can get why if you were a fan of SCP's like rock grunge stuff and you hear this, I could totally understand if you think this is a throwaway song, but I'm like the opposite. I'm like, give me this song any day over Dead and Bloated. 100%.
Any day. Now,
Yes.
okay. I am so happy that this is like top tier for you. My turn to geek out now. This is maybe my favorite solo on the record, I'm pretty sure.
Okay.
I think
It is
there's
great.
three big solos on the album. And to me, I think this may be my favorite. It's just the tone's great, the playing's great. Just really usable licks. You know, and the rhythm guitar is Robert again. How many bands could have your bassist do one of the best guitar progressions on the whole entire record? Scott's vocal is like effortless. And it's interesting because you think of something like Hello, It's Late. It's a more warm, balanced vocal that's very silky. But it's almost done crude here. Like, it really does kind of almost sound like a live PA type vocal.
Yeah.
Over such a well-arranged, fleshed-out track. You had mentioned, yo, give me more Black Agains, more Hello, It's Late. And I'm with you. I think STP, for me, at their best, is when they do these produced songs. Same things that get them criticized. I actually like it. I think they're very creative, and they have the musical expertise and, you know, the technical skills to pull it off. And, yeah, as you can tell, this is one I just never get tired of. It always sounds great. And for me, like, once I hit this song on the album, I think for me, this is where I'm like, yeah, this is where the goodness starts. I do like the first half of the record, and I can see where Lady Picture Show for some people is a big plus, but for me, this is where you enter Vibeville.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, this song is like would fit so many different occasions, and definitely the first couple times I listened to this album, it was at night, where like I'm the only one awake in the house, and I just got my headphones on. And I make sure most of the times I listen to these albums, I don't multitask. I just listen. But then I listen to this album. So this is probably the album maybe I've listened to the most doing these album for album episodes, that I would put it on while I was like driving or when I was reading, and it fit those vibes too. So like, yeah, this song is just, it's vibey, but
it always hits.
Yeah. I love that guitar tone. I love the rhythm. I love the actual notes, the slides. Like, and it doesn't really get old. Like you were saying, it's just always good.
You know, I think you could argue that is like, I think some of the beauty in some of the other songs on the record is that it is rough around the edges. But to me, I think this is like the most perfect song, you know, the cleanest song. The least, yeah. I mean, I guess you could take the lyrics as being the one rough part, but
yeah,
you know, we could go on for hours. But we get to the biggest song from the record, I would say.
So this one actually did better as a single than Big Bang Baby, because for some reason, I always thought, like, I knew this was a popular song, and I knew it was a single. And every time this band is brought up on videos, this is a lot of people's, like, they'll say their favorite SCP song.
Really?
Or a lot of the times they'll say, like, the most underrated. And a lot of it is because of the bass work. But I thought it was more of, like, a fan favorite than, like, this song did great on the charts or whatever. And I know, like, the songs that did the best on the charts was probably from their first two albums, right? But
well, I'll say this is the only one from this record that I ever have heard on a radio, actually. Which
okay,
is why,
see,
to
I
me,
swore
I
may have
think
heard
of it.
Big Bang Baby once, but I might be.
But I feel like your California stations are a little bit more varied.
I meant that as like growing up, not like.
Recently. Oh, really?
Yeah. No, the only I don't hear anything. I will say the only song I'll hear on the radios here that isn't from the first two albums is I will hear Sour Girl on the radio,
which I am jealous of.
Yeah, but it's because, but it's not even because I live here. It's because I listen to Sirius Radio, which is like premium channels where they have much better mixes. True. But regardless, I'm gonna have a controversial opinion. I don't think this is a top three song from the album, and I'm almost gonna go to a point where I think this song is a little overrated. And let me make my case, and then you can tell me if I'm out of pocket for it.
Okay.
I think, first of all, I think the bass work is phenomenal, but I don't like the way it's mixed. I feel like if I heard a live version where the mixing was better, it would just stand out more to me. I like the song for how kind of like fast it is. And I'm glad that they had one of these songs near, like, I'm glad that the rockers weren't only in the first half of the album. So I appreciate that, because I would assume this is like where we get to the midpoint / second half. Like if on vinyl, I'm sure this would be on side two.
Right, right.
Here's my thing. I think the verses, they're easier to get into than the chorus. But the verses, I was like, isn't this just kind of like another kind of Vaseline type song? Like the vocal melody of like, is that not kind of similar? I'm not talking about the notes, or I'm not talking about like the tone. I'm just talking about the phrasing.
Okay.
Kind of similar.
If I agree, let me make a completely opposing argument with it. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. It starts off that vocal hook. Yeah, yeah. You're right. It is pretty damn similar to start off, but I will say this though. Vaseline, first off, that is a 2-note riff. That is super cool because it's like a poly, it's a polymeter. I think it's another thing where like the riff's in three, but like the drums are in four or whatever.
It's also the riff of Monument by the Frames.
Shut the hell up.
A little faster.
and this song actually has like a chord progression underneath it, and it's a very syncopated rhythm.
Yeah.
I will say, you are completely right. The bass is mixed kind of flat here, but I think they pull it off well. I think what it does is it separates this really bright, jangly guitar, and it leaves this huge room for all these words Scott's throwing at you. And once he does the little hook thing, he does the whole chromatic, you know, how about, okay, continue. I'm getting ahead of myself here.
Well, okay, so I'll say this. Like, the verses, they were easy to get into, but I wouldn't say I was impressed. Which, I know I've said that a lot in this episode. I don't need a song to impress me for me to like it, but I'm just saying, like, it didn't impact me as much.
But the bass goes off the walls, man.
It does, but I don't know. I don't like the way it's mixed as much. Like, this is one of the songs where, like, I don't think I would ever be able to play this on bass because I just don't think my skills are up to chop, right? But
My biggest flex is that for Battle of the Bands, I played it on bass and I sang it.
Oh, wow. Yeah, see,
I don't know how I mustered it, but
I could sing the song, but I could not sing it and play along to it. And I couldn't play along to it without singing even, but.
And you are also, right. The live versions rip.
Yeah, I'll have to listen to one. Now the chorus, it took me actually like a week or so to get into it. The chorus I was like struggling with because I did not like the way his vocal sounded. And maybe it was a little bit of the mixing. Like, it sounded like his vocals had like some weird static kind of filter, but then also the tone of his voice I didn't love. So, and then like the chorus, the music is a lot more dramatic and a lot like darker than like the verse, which usually I like when that happens because there's dynamics, there's contrast. But it was just almost so much of a contrast that it took me a little bit to get into. But I will say now I really like the chorus. And I think what helped me was this song, like lyrically, this song supposedly was written about one time when he was tripping on acid, which is kind of where like the title of the song comes from, right?
Right, right.
And like a lot of like the verses, I know there's some specific references like to when he sings Old Lead Belly, you know, but like the verses kind of feel more like that Bowie, like just writing like the first thing that comes to your mind. But I will say there is a narrative to the song, which was his bad acid trip. But like the chorus is where the song kind of has more of a steady like structure, because like the line where he sings, "I'm not myself, I'm not dead, and I'm not for sale," was very like, oh, okay, like, and maybe it's more effective. That sounds a little mean to say, but like, I didn't really, even though the song was big, I didn't really know this song too much before going into this album. Like, there's really no song on this album I knew before going into
right,
it.
Right.
But I assume fans were, this song was a little hard to listen to after he passed away because of that line where he sings, "I'm not dead, I'm not for sale." And I just feel like that's another line on this album that has to do with like being a rock star and feeling like you're in this music industry for the wrong reasons, like, you know, to make money and not to, you know, write music that is meaningful to you. And I did research and I found that he wrote a memoir, autobiography, with the help of someone. And that's, he named the book after that lyric, I'm not dead, I'm not for sale. And I'll say this, I liked this album so much, I currently have that book on hold for me at the library, at my local library. I'm picking it up tomorrow. Yeah.
Even I haven't read it.
Yeah. And I saw some reviews because I want to say either it was his wife or ex-wife or girlfriend also wrote a book about him and her. And some people said like the stories don't line up. So like some people think in his book, he wasn't as open as the story she told in her book, but I'm still going to go into it with an open mind. But because I'm, after these two albums, I am becoming an STP fan. Right, I just don't know.
Yes.
If maybe you're going to have to work my way back into the early albums where I can maybe get into the heavier rock grunge stuff. But yeah, so I finally, when I kind of read the lyrics to the chorus, that's when the chorus kind of connected with me and like made more sense. And then the solo, it starts off great. And I like the dual solo, but then like when the other guitar comes in and the one that's panned to the right, it has like a farty tone to it that I do not like, that stays in the last chorus. And I do not like it.
Wait.
That sounds farty.
You're talking about like the searing, heroic, melancholy lead that comes in?
Yeah. But I'm not talking about like when the solo first starts, it sounds great. It just sounds like a classic rock, but
you're talking about the one that like mimics the guitar.
Yeah. I'm not saying I don't like the notes. I like the notes. I don't like the tone. It sounds like that. Like I don't like it.
I mean, okay, yeah. It is a very sharp slide guitar sound. But I don't know. I feel like at this point in the song, the drama has been built up so high in that chorus that it's, well, okay, here. Maybe I'll share my experience with the song. What I think is super cool about the song is it starts off and it's kind of quirky already with the opening chord. And you know, when it comes in, it starts off pretty dirt simple, right? Here's our chugga chugga riff, and then, you know, a good groove. Kind of like the first half of the album. But as soon as you hit the chorus, you're like, okay, wait, this song is very, like, it's very structured. Like, the parts are very separated, like you said. And then when you go back to the verse, it's even more fun and quirky. Like, you're like, okay, this has a lot of character, even though it's like a rock song, you know. And I don't know, to me, that's what makes it stands out, is that both chorus and verses are so strong in a different direction. And although I do agree that like the chorus, it does seem maybe to be more than just the acid trip, the verses do kind of fall back on that kind of goofy, is this just bullshit or is this a genuine stream of consciousness, right?
Yeah.
So I always get mixed feelings on that. But I don't know, I just think the intensity of that chorus is like really magical. I don't know. And I just think
it's delivery is genuine. No, I like it now. I like it now. Yeah. It's the verses that the verses to me hold back the song from being like an epic.
Still, a
little bit. Yeah. Like I like the song more than Bing Bang Baby. I will say that. But besides one other song, well, besides, there's two songs coming up that I would say this song I like better than it. But I don't know, this song I felt, I understand why people would say it's their favorite on the album or like top three, but there's at least three other songs I like more than this. One being And So It Goes, or, And So It Goes, thinking of Billy Joel, And So I Know, and then the other being Lady Picture Show. I like those two songs more than this song.
I will say, I think the production's very fun in this song. There's a lot going on when you're listening to it.
And it's almost too much for me.
Oh my gosh.
Mostly because of the farty guitar tone.
I am listening to it as we're doing this, and I hear where you're coming from. I don't think it's enough to deter me from, like, I don't think it would lower the song for me, though. I just think I'm so invested.
When you first heard it, that's because that wasn't in your mind when you first heard it, but it was in my mind when I first heard it. Not that I went into the song knowing that there was going to be a farty guitar tone, but.
So I think so far, every song, there's been some kind of caveat to it. Lady Picture Show, it's great, but the trash cans I could do without. And So I Know, get rid of the campfire girls. And those are all fair critiques.
Yeah, well,
but I do think it's interesting how you're. I wonder if there's going to be like a point on this album, even though it made it seem like your favorite song isn't on the second half. Is there going to be somewhere where you're like, you know what? No, I am fine. This song, I'm going to take it as is.
I'm not going to answer that, but I'm going to say this. I think that when I like an album, and maybe it's only for this podcast because we're doing it based off giving each other suggestions. When I really start to like an album, I to my own detriment, play devil's advocate too much. I will admit that. To be fair, I wrote these notes like 2 weeks ago, you know, because, you know, you've been sick, so we haven't been filming as soon as we normally would have, but part of me is now wondering, like, maybe this is payback for some of the things you said from last week's episode with Day for Night. But no, because these are things I have had written down for weeks now. But this album, we don't do like ratings on the show. And not because like I'm against ratings, and I really like to rank things, but like, let's say I consider this an A album. It's right now, because it's still so new to me, I feel like I can't say A+. And I am, some of the, like you said, caveats for me are keeping it back from being an A+. But this like could be like grenades where I care less about those caveats and really start enjoying the album just for what the songs are and not trying to look for their faults.
That is fair, because with like the Light Grenades example, there's like several songs on there that you and I both could just not have on the album and we'd be fine, but it doesn't seem to take the album down a notch.
Yeah. And where that's where this one is too.
Which I think it is kind of interesting what kind of determines when that's okay and when that's not okay.
Well, I'm just shocked. I mean, I think when I, you know, when we started this episode and I said like, I love this album, you were like super relieved, but I thought there'd be a little more pushback from you because you had made a comment when we were on the phone sometime last week in prep for this episode where, again, we usually don't spill our thoughts until the episode. Like these like discussions we have are in real time and are genuine. They're not fake. Like we don't, you know.
Well, I will say Rico was really struggling to not give away
well,
everything.
Well, yeah, as a,
he, this whole time he's been pushing
one
me.
One of my flaws just in life in general is I cannot keep surprises or secrets. I ask Lindsay, like I just cannot. Anytime I like buy a gift for her for Christmas or birthday, I'm terrible at keeping. It's not even like a secret. It's just I'm terrible at like surprises and stuff. So I've been wanting to do this episode for like weeks now because I just had such strong positive feelings on it. But I thought there'd be more pushback because you had mentioned you were like, oh, you're going to end up liking Tiny Music way more than my favorite album, Shangri-La-Di-Da. And you said something like, oh, that'd be bullshit because of blah, 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 blah. So I thought you were going to be mad that this was so far my favorite STP album.
Well, okay. But okay. I will say this, though. There is a okay. You're right. You kind of caught me. You kind of caught me with my pants down here. So there are some songs on this record that we haven't gotten to yet that to me are some of the most special moments on the record and or iconic, memorable, impactful moments. I think are on this second half of this album. And for the reasons I think they are great, they're flaws in a way is what makes them great. There is genius in them, but they're not perfect. Now, the first half of the record, I think is good, great, but I know it's not the band's, max potential. Like Tumble in the Rough, it's good. It's not perfect. It could be better. Pops Love Suicide, I think is really good and contained. I think it's cool, but it's maybe not as polished as maybe like Trippin' or, outside the album, Interstate Love Song.
Yeah.
So I'm just happy so far that given this batch of rock songs, you are liking it. Lady Picture Show, it does kind of seem like a you song. And so I know I'm just so glad you love it. I'm pumped for it. Trippin', I'm surprised you weren't fully on board for it, to be
Yeah.
honest. But it's kind of this next stream of songs. This is kind of where I'm gonna either have to be mad at you even though you like a song, or I'm gonna have to hate you because you don't understand a song. This is the part where I start getting really protective. And so I know is where I got protective from.
So you're saying that you're going to be as protective for this next song, which is Art School Girlfriend? Art School Girl? Art School Girlfriend. What is
Well,
the...
okay, Art School Girl.
Oh,
This
yeah.
is a song that we all know it's better than it should be. You can't not like this song. And I know you're gonna say it's in your top three just because you want to fuck with me or something.
Let me just get this out of the way. This song, on my first listen, I was like, wow, that was dog shit. What was that? I'm like, this was terrible. I'm like, okay, sorry, Tumble in the Rough. Why was I so hard on you earlier? Like, this song is like, yeah, it starts off with kind of a cool, funky bass groove, but then like the guitar riff is like dorky. You got Scott's like really like I don't even know how to describe it, just like his delivery. Got a girlfriend. She went to art. Like, it's just not there. That's not it. The lyrics are just like almost like, did he go out of his way to make them like comical? Like, were they supposed to be funny? And then like when the percussion comes in, like during the second part of like the verse, where it's like the what is it? Like a what is that instrument
Is
where
it the
it's
clave?
yep, that's the one. I'm like, I think this is like a cake song now at this point. And yeah, I'm not like the
Too
biggest
far.
cake fan because they have a couple of good songs, but they have a sound that every song sounds the same, where like you always have that little weird cowbell thing and then the horns, and I'm like, this sounds like a cake song. And then like the chorus is just, again, the contrast is just so, it's so abrasive. It's just like it goes completely rock. Scott is just like yelling this like nonsensical lyric where it's, I told you five or four times. And we don't ever learn what, like who he's talking to or what he told them five or four times about. We never learn that. And like the guitar leads and like the chorus reminded me of something from like Queens of the Stone Age.
Yes,
But
I'm glad you felt that.
like the Queens of the Stone Age that I don't love, that you love, like
Shit.
the early work. And then like by the time you get to the bridge, I was just like I'm like they're pulling our leg. Like this is like their Vitalogy where they're throwing on a Bugs or a Stupid Mop, right? Like I'm like they're putting me on, right? So, and then it ends with like that weird backing robot sounding vocal.
Where he's
That,
just croaking it out. I told you
yeah.
five or four times.
And I'm just like, no. But I'll tell you this. Second time I listened to the album, I'm like, yep, that's still the worst song. Third time, I'm like, Okay, well, I kind of appreciate at least they put the song in between two kind of more serious songs. So I'm like, I kind of like the placement. Fourth time, I'm like, wow, that chorus is still too much, but why is it stuck in my head? Like the seventh or eighth time I heard it, I'm like, wait, why does the bridge kind of work? Like, why does those chords sound really like cool, atmospheric, spacey? And like, why do the nahs, like, why does that section work? And then why does it actually work that it goes back into that abrasive chorus? And then I just finally had to admit, this is not a good song, but yet somehow I enjoy it. Now it's not top three, definitely not
Okay.
top
Okay.
three, but I still think I enjoy more than Double in the Rough, even if I still think this is the worst song on the album, like from a songwriting standpoint, because it still is. Like the lyrics are just, and like the lyrics, they're
There's
kind
some
of
good
like,
lines, though.
they're kind of autobiographical, but they're not, because he did have a art school girlfriend, but she wasn't from Alabama, like how he states in the song. And like supposedly, like she went to like a college, and he worked like at a like the paper that the college put out, right? Like he did
Oh,
some type of journalism.
I didn't even know that part.
Hold on, let me pull up the specifics here. He dated someone who did go to an art school in California, Orange County. And as she was taking classes at the California Institute of the Arts, he got a job at a legal newspaper called the Daily Journal. So, yeah, that there's some meaning to the lyrics, I guess, but they're just the way they're delivered are just
I
so
think the
like.
best there's one good chunk of lyrics. I kind of said a few good lines, but there's one section that has good lyrics, which to me is let me see if I can actually read it accurately here. She wears the leather, I wear the makeup. We'll never break up, been together for a month. That's kind of just a funny line to begin with, but I think it kind of captures the whole song. Like it's just like such a like a meaningless thing, like, you know, to him. Like it is a meaningless song, but I don't know. I think that's the most interesting lines. But I think the delivery is way more important than the actual lyrics. I think this song does have an importance kind of in the Scott vocal lore, if I'm just kind of coining this on the spot here. So you take like core and you have like these super, I'm trying to be this 90s grunge monster, like, you know, vocal approach, right? And then you get to Purple, which is just a more tasteful, relaxed, almost more twangy, you know, at times version of that. And then you have this album where it's very raw and punk and feeble at times. But then you take this song, it's this effortless kind of country thing going for the verses. Then the punk scream yell, you know, for the chorus. And then you get that really pretty nah section of the bridge that you'll see in later work. And so this is where Scott really shows his chameleon abilities in a one bite-sized song. And I think later songs, not really on this record, he'll switch between voices for different sections. So I think this song, like you said, like, yeah, it's really not the best song. None of the progressions or riffs are that memorable necessarily by themselves on paper. But come on, I told you five or four times, that section is so iconic. It's a highlight of the record.
Yeah, and it's a lot of people's least favorite from the album, and I totally understand why. And it, like I said, it's still like it is probably the worst song, but
But it's more interesting than Tumble in the Rough,
it is,
except
and it's
lyrics.
more, and it's more memorable too. Yeah, like it's the, yeah, there's just things that stick with me more. It's like it's not quite like a film or a show that it's so bad it's good, but it's close to that. It's close to that feeling where you're like.
It's still structured like a real song, though. It's not a shit post, okay?
But all the sections are the only section I think that is like really good is the bridge, but only the nah part. Like when it goes back into that chorus, it's kind of gimmicky, but the nah section is so good. Like the nah section would be so good in another song, but maybe it only works so well in this song because of the contrast. I don't know. It's one of those things where you'll never really know, but
Yeah, it was just, you know,
yeah.
a perfect storm, we'll say.
Yeah. So you go from that song, which is really kind of goofy and silly, and you get to the next track, adhesive. And after my first listen of Adhesive, I was like, this is my favorite song on the album. And but I will say, I wasn't sure. I after the song finished, I was like, that is technically the best song on the album, but I think I like And So I Know more, and maybe even Lady Picture Show. By my fourth listen to the album, I'm like, no, I definitely like it more than Lady Picture Show, but I still think I like And So I Know more. But then it just got to a point where I'm like, I'm kidding myself. This is my favorite. This is the song that I will go and listen to on its own the most. And I'm going to get serious here for a second. Not that I haven't been this whole episode, but this is the, out of any song on any album you showed me so far, this is the one that blew me away the most. And at least on this podcast, the music we've listened to, this is the song that has moved me the most. And for a lot of reasons. And, you know, it kind of sucks that this song is in this placement of the album, because I want to talk about it for like hours and hours, but I already know this podcast, we're already at the one and a half hour mark here. And we because I think we started right at 8. And we still have like 3 more songs after this. Well, one of them is going to be a short talk, but it deserves the time. So I'm not going to rush my thoughts on it. I think we're going to have very similar thoughts. So that'll be good, because I don't think we're going to have a lot of disagreements, but the song blew me away, but like in pieces and slowly. It starts off very moody. And it's like, okay, this is a very dark sounding song. And I almost didn't like it at first, because I'm like, this is kind of what I picture some of the slower songs on like their first couple of albums being, like a Plush or something. And that's just for someone who only kind of knows the hits, and even the hits I don't listen to a lot, right? Like, I'm like, is this kind of like a Creep or something, you know? Their song, Radiohead's Creep.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
Yeah, maybe Plush wasn't the right song, but like one of those songs. But like even before the vocals come in, I'm like, no way, there's a lot more to the song. There is this little acoustic lick in the song that happens every now and again in the verses that I absolutely love. It's like haunting, it's sad, and the song is sad and it's very moody. And if you don't like those type of songs, you will not like the song. And thankfully, I am a fan of those type of songs. They're not usually my favorite songs, which is why I'm shocked I like the song as much as I do. But what I love about that little guitar lick is it sounds fresh, because the song actually still sounds very massive. Like, it has a good blend of acoustic and electric guitars, and the production is kind of all over the place in a good way. But then, like, right after that lick, you get a couple little short jabs on an electric keyboard of some kind that I fucking love. And so already I'm like, the details on the song are fantastic, and the lyrics haven't even come in. And then you get the lyrics, and you get Scott's vocals. And this is, I mean, I don't know how you can't say that this is the darkest song on the album. It's the most personal, it's the most heart-wrenching, and you know, we're not going to go through all the lyrics, because the lyrics are fantastic, and I don't, a lot of them actually aren't even super obvious. A lot of them actually have a lot of like hidden meanings, but all the hidden meanings all stem from the song being about his drug addiction. And you have like very specific lines of like, you know, when he sings at the beginning, "My friend Blue, he runs the show." Like, a lot of people think that Blue is like a metaphor for when he uses heroin, it turns blue when you like do a chemical test to it. Plus, like, it, you know, the depression, like feeling blue. So that's what I'm saying. Like, every line has like super like double meanings. When he talks about purple. Later in the song, he sings about like purple flowers, and that, first of all, some people are like, oh, that's in regards to their album Purple, but then also it's in regards to poppies and like how
you get opium
from the poppies, which is why there's the line, he picks a fruit but keeps it whole. Like, there's so many lyrics in the song where there's just so many, and like I said, they all really stem from his drug addiction and abuse. And, you know, I, as someone who has, you know, not had those issues before, like, you think the song would be hard for me to connect to, especially to an artist or band that I don't have very special attachments to, unlike you. And that's the whole reason why we do this show, this segment on our podcast, because we're trying to get each other into different bands and stuff. And I don't connect to the song on a personal level. And usually when that happens, I can't fall for a song as much as I do for other songs. But in this case, it's the opposite. Like, it's the lyrics, the more you read them, the more just like somber and sad, but like they work. Even like a simple line, like can't keep from submarining. Like, that's just, I've never before heard of that like word and a verb for this specific thing, like for in a song. So like his choice of words in the song are like super well thought out. Like, I don't know, like, I'd be shocked if somewhere he had said, oh, I came up with a song in 5 minutes. Like, no, this isn't like a Green Day, the time of your life situation. Like, no, like, this is a song where I feel like he took forever to write, probably because it's just so detailed and well thought out.
Well, and here's the thing for me, because I know you and I, and we probably will do this at some point, probably several times. We probably will have hour long discussions on this song.
Yeah.
But what I think is super interesting, especially as we're going through the whole album, is that this song, you look at the lyrics and you could easily read it as a few different things. You could see it as Scott just venting out, you know, like, here's like everything that I, you know, I'm feeling, that I'm upset about, that's bothering me, all these emotions in one go. And when you look at it like that, it's kind of like some of the other songs in the album, a stream of consciousness, except perfectly done and very somberly done. But you could also look at it as something a little more maybe thought out and wordplay heavy, kind of like a Gourd thing, since we just talked about Hip on the last episode. And, you know, like, I think, you know, especially, you know, we're looking at genius.com song meanings and stuff, people are going to attribute different things, and, you know, we're going to overlook things. One of the themes that I had kind of thought about is, because before I got into this one, Bipolar Bear was like the closest I got to like, oh, like a really sad like Scott song, right?
Yeah.
Which talks about like bipolar. There is a lot of lines in the song that you could kind of maybe attribute to that same sort of deal. I think realistically it's probably more just about his drug abuse, but being able to interpret that way is cool. Such as like, his family trees are molded, no longer grows in summer. He holds it closer, lets it go, picks a fruit, but keeps it whole. It's like these very big emotional attachments, you know, whether that's just a mood, like depression, mania, or if it's, you know, his attachment to a drug and what he feels from it. Like,
no, I agree. Deep song. I agree. And I actually really think some of the song is about like his bipolarness and stuff, because like I get this a lot from the chorus, or at least the first chorus, because there's almost like two choruses in the song. There's almost like a post chorus. Like, I don't know exactly what you want to call it, but the part when he sings, grab the hate and drown it out, grab the beat and drum it out. It's so confusing. That to me also can be like a theme of his feelings that made him maybe want to, you know, use drugs in the first place to kind of get his emotions stable. And really, just really did the opposite, you know?
Right.
At least in the long-term effect. But then, like you said, there's layers to the song, but there's like a third layer, which is you get it in the second verse. Because, well, first of all, I mean, going to that chorus that I just talked about, I really like the music where The chorus comes way earlier than I thought it would, but again, I can almost consider it like chorus.
I think
one
of it
or
as a
pre-chorus. I think it is too. I think it's a pre-chorus, but the way that it goes from verse to pre-chorus back to verse, it makes you think it's like an REM thing where it's like it's a false chorus, because right. later you get the real chorus. But in that pre-chorus section, the bass comes in super like distorted and heavy and really loud in the mix. And I like that that's kind of in that section, that's what kind of controls the song, besides Scott's like vocals, which become more passionate in that section. Because in the verse, he's really held back. One, because I think the verses they're wordy, they're more wordy, so he has to kind of fit them in better. But I really love the melody in the verses because it's somehow super catchy. Like even right now, reading the words, I can hear the highs and lows in the melody when he sings it.
Right, which for this quantity of lyrics, to be able to just kind of read the whole thing, hearing it is impressive. And also, too, the pre-chorus is in 7, I believe, something like that. It does something odd there, which kind of, it really does feel kind of like you're jerking around compared to this, the verse of which you mentioned, which is just this big sustained burst of energy, you know, with then some clarity in it. And the contrast of Scott's like really feeble, like off pitch performance. Like it's a very unrefined performance, but the vulnerability is unreal in this song.
Yeah. And that I think really happens a lot in the second verse, because the third kind of meaning I get from the song is in the second verse, I almost hear this. He's singing the song in the second verse. It almost seems like he's singing the song to the society and to fans and to his peers in the music industry, because he sings, "It's not the same for you and me." He sings the line, "Comatose commodity." And then he follows that up with the superheroes dying, children crying. And I see that as the superheroes in the song are maybe other rock stars like Kim, who have lost their lives to drug addiction, like, you know, Lane from Alice in Chains, or
Kurt,
or even the lead singer of, I'm forgetting his name, of Blind Melon, too. He
Shannon Hoon?
Yeah. And, you know, the timelines for these are all different, but like, you know, like dying, being a rock star and dying and overdosing from drugs was such a real thing. It still is, unfortunately. But in the second verse, you know, really too, when you hit the lyric, the line where he sings, "Sell more records if I'm dead," which, oh man, that again, I only heard the song for the first, I mean, I maybe have heard you play it before, but I was an idiot back then when you would try to show me music, so I just didn't pay attention to it. So I never heard the song before he passed away. But that's like a line that it's so unfortunate, because it almost has more impact, sadly, now that he's gone. But even before he passed away, that line is just, it's so much, because it's like, yeah, sometimes when a musician passes away, they almost get more popularity, right? Or at least they right. do for a week, a month, or whatever. And when I first heard the song, I thought the line that he sung, I thought he said, "Sell my records when I'm dead."
Oh.
So I was like, oh, that's like, that's kind of a cool, like, it's not a cool line, but I'm like, that's like a interesting line. But then like when I read the lyric, I was like, oh no, like he's singing about maybe I'd be better off dead because I'd sell more records.
And you compare that to, like, because we mentioned, especially at the beginning of this record, a lot of songs maybe about stardom, and like Big Bang Baby, you know, I want to cry, but I gotta laugh. And he's almost saying it kind of like he's going crazy, or you could even, he's kind of whiny, maybe bratty even. But then you hear him say something this, just this clear, transparent.
Or even like the, "I'm not dead and I'm not for sale," too.
Right.
Here, after hearing this song, this is the song that made me appreciate the chorus of that song more.
Okay, that checks out then.
But then we get to my absolute favorite moment on this entire album, which is when he sings the line down the river, I'm not going to lie. I got actually very emotional when I heard this for the first time. It's one of those things where it's almost hard to put into words why that line made me feel the way it did. It's a lot of it has to do with the melody, because like I said, this song, it's got a great melody in the verses, but it's very, it rhymes, right? And it flows. But when he gets to the line where he sings down the river, the melody changes. It flows more like a river. It's like, it is less, it's almost less cohesive, but in a good way. It's you're not expecting it the first time you ever hear the song. And you're like kind of taken back, because you're like, whoa. And his vocal approach is the most vulnerable I've ever heard his vocals. And the tone is just perfect for that line. And the first time he sings that line, just like the first half down the river, in my head, I almost, and not in a bad way, like I was like, oh, go up, go higher. And he did exactly that. So it was like a payoff that like, and it was such a short amount of time for that payoff, because as he's singing it, I'm like, oh, I want more of that. And then he does it again. And I'm like, oh, that's perfect. The way he just, his vocal line is kind of ascending. And then just the line itself, it's super simple. It's the most like simple line in the entire song. And it's one of those lines, again, where it's hard to put into words, because I don't, there's many different meanings I've read. One I read is that going down the river is the narrator acknowledging the passing of time. But then someone said it might be in reference to the closing song from their album Core called Where the River Goes.
Oh, that one?
Yeah, Down the River, Where the River Goes.
I thought you were going to say the closing track from Purple, Kitchenware and Candy Bars.
No, I didn't see anything about that song.
That song is about an abortion that he had with his like first wife.
Oh.
And one of the tags in the song is Sell Me Down the River. And it's done in such more of like a brooding, sell me down the river sort of way. And so it is interesting to hear this much more feeble, just emotional, just like,
yeah,
down the river.
And then like the third interpretation I thought of is like maybe with the phrase you're down the river without a paddle, which is like he's screwed.
Yeah.
And all four of those interpretations of just this three word line is so, that to me, this is like what impacts me. And this is what makes me cling to this song in particular. And like I said, it was a moment just in that song. And he does it again in the third verse. And it hits hard then too.
When it comes up, you think you can't, like, you're like, why are you going back to this?
Yeah.
Like, that was a one-off thing.
Yeah.
But what they do to make it emotional in a different way
the
is
harmony,
he does, yeah,
right?
All these harmonies that are very unique sounding. And yeah, it's just like, it's good.
Yeah, and then like the second verse, like, well, in both verses, but like right after that line, it goes back into the pre-chorus with the heavy bass, right? And then I will say this, on the first couple lessons of the song, when you get to what we're considering is the chorus where he sings Adhesive Love, I was kind of like, this is my least favorite part of the song, because his vocals kind of start going into that range that I don't love as much, especially not as much as the other portions in this song. So I was like a little disappointed. And then the backing vocals that do the love where it kind of comes
right
in, that was a little off-putting too. But again, it grew on me. The backing vocals grew on me. The fact that his vocals are more passionate and broken sounding during this chorus grew on me. And even just like the simple lyric of him just singing Adhesive Love, like it's another line where it's like, okay, is he talking specifically about, heroin, like the black tar and how it's like super sticky and it could be like an adhesive? Is he
addicted to something? Is he stuck to it?
Yeah.
He like, can't get out of it?
Can he only love when he is high? Like there's so many like, yeah, interpretations. And again, he keeps it simple by you know, the rest of the song is super detailed, but then, yeah, the chorus, he kind of leaves it more up for interpretation. And then, like, when I think the song, like, can't get better, you get a goddamn trumpet solo in the middle of the song, which I first thought it was sax, but I'm pretty sure it's trumpet, right?
I thought it was sax, too. I was a fool. It's trumpet.
And then when I first heard it on my first listen, I'm like, is this a goddamn E Street Band record? Like, what am I listening to? But in a good way, because I love horns in songs. I love Bruce Springsteen and the E Street Band. I love Clarence Clemens, you know, but like I was not expecting that on this. And now I do, because then I'm like, oh, yeah, this fits with like and So I Know and
right.
Lady Picture Show and the upcoming instrumental song. Like I'm like it fits all of those marks, you know, but. Yeah, I was not expecting it on this song, and it's a beautiful solo, and it definitely I think is better than what could have been a guitar solo.
Right. It's well, there's a few things that make it so special. First off, you talk about that chorus, which is very, very high energy, backup vocals, you know, it's, you know, the yelling vocal. And then you get like a brief pause where it's a sustain on a distorted chord. And then Eric with the drums, the simplest thing. And then straight trumpet. And like the lines, they're played very vocally. They're very like legato.
Mm-hmm.
But there's space in between it. And then you can really hear the like the electric keys come in
acoustic,
that section.
Yeah, and that little acoustic riff. Yeah.
Right. It's like you go back to the atmosphere that you had built for so long in the song and you just hit it extra hard.
Yeah. And I will say, I think this is a song that I would not have. I'm shocked you appreciated the song when you. Because how old do you think you were when you like first heard the song and got into this album?
Maybe like 15.
Yeah, see, I don't think I would have been mature enough at that age to get the song. Which is probably why I'm sure you showed me the song when we were younger, and I probably just found it annoying or something.
Funny enough, this song has some backstory. So I remember I was listening to this album a lot, like in the summer and stuff, and you were letting me use your Spotify account.
Okay.
And you got mad at me because I fell asleep with the song on repeat. And so it made your number one spot
on the Wrapped. Yeah.
But little do you know that this could maybe actually end up being on your top Unwrapped list.
Oh, I think it will. Yeah. I think this, right? This will be top 10. Cause like I said, this is the song on the album, not the only, but this is probably the one song that I go back to the most outside of this album. And I will say it's not a song I can listen to in any occasion. It's not. And So I Know where it fits the vibe for any occasion.
Right.
Like this worked perfect. This song, Adhesive, worked perfect when I was driving like in the rain the other night. Like that was great, but like, yeah, it's not going to work great on a sunny day when I'm outside mowing the grass, you know, like it has its time and place, which is why I'm like, I struggled for a while. And I'm like, oh, And So I Know is my favorite on the album. But then just the more I listen to Adhesive, I'm like, I'm kidding myself. Adhesive is the best and it is my favorite.
Okay.
Even just for the Down the River part, I'm like, just for that part alone, because that part still stuns me every time I listen to the song.
I will say two more comments. I know we got to move on here, but two comments. You said won't work in the sun mowing the lawn, but hear me out though. In the sun, when you're just having a day where you're not connecting with anyone, like you just can't deal with it. Hearing this song.
Oh yeah, I mean you can be depressed on a sunny day for sure. Oof. I'm just yeah.
It's that contrast. Yeah. And then I also do really like how after the trumpet solo, you get like a third verse, which is like kind of basically repeating the end of the second verse, which is kind of interesting to me. But the part that I want to talk about is when they go back to that last pre-chorus, there's an extended pre-chorus. And so he starts off with stitch the womb and wet the bed with the whisper, I'll be dead. Fucking love it.
Oh, I like
it. It hits so hard.
I like the following line, I think the best out of those lines, which is don't let the living die yet. Where that's like maybe the other part in the song where he gets really passionate in the vocals. Because I think throughout some of this album in the song, I think like what was the song where he's singing like Tumble in the Rough? Like that song, I think he's singing about wanting to get better, kind of. And I think in this song, that line is him like kind of like his plea, like his begging, like plea for help, like someone help me, you know. And from what I've done a little reading online and what I think I'm going to get by reading his biography was that he was kind of a closed off person, and I think it was maybe hard for him to open up, And maybe he did that way more in his music, but maybe not like in his personal life, you know. Which again, that's all speculation. It's not like I knew the guy or whatever, and I barely know anything about him. But you know, like, yeah, like this song is just, and I know this is like a fan favorite and one of the songs that he never played live with the band, which sucks. But maybe for the better. And not even because they wouldn't be able to do like the trumpet solo, but like, I just think this song, if you were to do it live, you have to nail it. And I did listen to the Chester Bennington version that he did live with the band. It was good. And it was better than what the average person could do as a cover, but it doesn't come close to touching the original. And I'll say this too. You said you loved the instrumental version on the anniversary. I don't, because my favorite part of the song really is the lyrics and the vocals. I do love the music, and I love the sax by itself and the acoustic guitar and the keys, but this song works because of Scott for me.
You could say he is the glue for this song.
That's true.
Well, I would say I do think it's a valuable track because the instrumental is so good as well.
Yeah.
But I do agree with you. I don't like the vocals. It's definitely like a really rough, vulnerable performance, but it is just so captivating and perfect in that way. And what is so interesting to me is that Scott is someone who does sing in, maybe not so much sings as characters, but he sings in different voices and very stylistically artsy. And sometimes I think he blends those lines a little bit. And in this song, he's totally not doing any voice. He's being him.
Yeah.
And I think it's very clear he's doing that, and it's very, the payoff is wonderful.
Yeah. So, I mean, we could talk another hour about this song, but this is probably going to end up being one of our longest episodes, and we still have three more songs to talk about.
All right, speedrun.
Well, I don't want to speedrun, because the next song, Ride the Cliché, when it first started with that like opening guitar riff, I was afraid, because it was abrasive, and it was not what I wanted after Adhesive. And for some reason, it gave me vibes of Regeneration, like the parts I don't like, though.
Not that opening chord, but they do use that the Regeneration chord in there. I'm glad you caught that.
So I was like, oh no, I'm like, the second half of this album, other maybe for art school girl, like, I'm like, this is going to be the one dud on this side of the album. But like immediately after that intro, they go into a more like an Interstate Love Song riff, where it kind of sounds like a little part bluesy, a little part, not country, but kind of like bluegrass. It's hard to describe, but that riff is just really, like, it flows really great. It has good tones. Like, the way the bass moves with the guitars and the drums is just really like kind of freeing. And I was like, oh, thank God that riff isn't like the main riff of the song.
You almost thought they fumbled it.
Yeah. But then actually that riff comes back in the chorus, if I'm not mistaken, but it's kind of hidden to where I didn't notice it in the first couple listens. But now when I listen to it, I'm like, wait, I like it in the chorus. I like that intro. I just didn't like it as an intro.
Yeah, what is cool about the song is that they do that thing where you like, you'll take like the chorus, I'm going to butcher it, but like you take like the chorus, and at the end of the song, you have your verse, you have your chorus, and at your final chorus, you sing your verse over the chorus.
Yeah.
And then including adding that intro riff in there. It's really clever how they take, you know, a few parts and they really arrange it to be something memorable and detailed.
Yeah, and
so it sounds like a straightforward song, but it isn't. But also the parts themselves are actually interesting parts that you don't hear on like every song you ever hear. Like, I don't know.
And really the only really straightforward part about this song, I would say, is the lyrics, because it is kind of one of those more elusive songs where I'm not sure what it's about, because like,
really?
One website, someone claim that the song is the personification of drug use, which is maybe like, okay, Ride the Cliché, like maybe like that's like a drug term, like I don't know. And then another website said like, oh, Ride the Cliché is about the Pearl Jam controversy. And I was like, what does that mean? And then like I tried to do some investigation, and I'm like, Is that like, do they mean like when people compared STP and especially Scott's voice to Eddie Vedder's voice? And I'm like, is the cliche that like they're a grunge rock band? So I don't know. Maybe you can align me. Maybe there's like a third meaning that actually is the meaning.
Well, okay. As I read the lyrics, like on paper, like, okay, I think it's pretty hard to say this is what the song's about. But I thought this was every band gets a prostitute song. I think this is the prostitute song.
Oh, really?
I don't know. I think for me, just because you are so cliched, it don't mean you won't get paid. I think he's kind of taking that classic trope of like, you know, like a song about like a prostitute and stuff. Roxanne, Candy's Room. It's like every band seems to have one. What was the one song? So Hard Done By, where it feels like that.
Yeah. But also, couldn't this actually loop back to what I think is actually the album's main theme, which is about rock stardom? Couldn't this be about being in a rock band is cliche, but that doesn't mean that you won't make good money from it?
Well, also, Barely Know You, Know My Name.
Well, okay,
Trip the Witch and Ride the Shame.
Well, actually,
he does say Trip the Bitch.
But Trip the Witch is actually a reference to a side STP band that I learned.
It became side STP band. Yeah. Which, by the way, I have not looked up. So I don't know why.
I read too that during the making of this album, the guitarist and the bassist made their own side band. And
with Eric, yes.
Yeah, so it was like STP without Scott. And like they almost at times weren't sure which song was going to make which album. And I read a quote where it's like, I don't know, maybe Tripping is going to end up on the side project band. And I'm like, what? Like, I'm like, why would you put like the biggest single on your album on a album that no one's going to listen to? No offense to that side project band, but.
I totally forgot to mention that at the start of this episode, the talk show record, which is everyone except Scott, with Dave Coutts, who I think is from like Porno for Pyros or something like that.
Okay, I've heard that name.
And I will say it, no spoilers. I will give that record down the road. I think we should pursue the Scott path first with STP. But yeah. I think it's a great record, but it's much more of a standard record. Like the songs are songs, but that's another story. But yeah, I really like Ride the Cliché. I think it's one of their most underrated rock songs.
I like how upbeat it is after Adhesive.
Right.
Like, at least musically, it sounds like so much lighter, and you need that after Adhesive.
Yes, yes. Agreed. And I think what it does really well, too, I'm kind of stealing your show here. I'm so sorry. I really like the solo section. I think on this record, a lot of the songs are a couple riffs, and then here's this section with brand new chords just for the solo, which is cool that they did that in this album. You know, they tried that idea several times. I think it works beautifully because they didn't rush it. It's a long solo that kind of does the art school girl thing where it goes kind of heavy, kind of like upbeat, but then we get this dramatic section. You know, it's cool.
Well, and I'll say this too. I really like the solo because I like the tone of the guitar. Is it a slide solo?
So it's a few different. It sounds like a few different guitar tracks. Like it starts
it's
with
very
like this,
interesting.
Yeah,
it's
a lot of textures.
If the solo didn't exist in Lady Picture Show, or the soloing like in And So I Know, this would probably be my favorite solo because it's so unique and cool. It's a little bit more flashy than like the solo I think in like Pops Love Suicide or the solo even in Trippin' or even on the closing track. Like those songs have good solos, but this one I think I like because of how unique it sounds, the tones. And I was gonna say the only thing about the song that was kind of weird for me, but it's not a knock on the song, but I just found it funny that the chorus is basically Tiny Dancer.
What do you mean?
Well, what does he sing in the chorus? Hold me closer. And he even sings it like Tiny Dancer. Like, imagine a sped up Tiny Dancer. Hold me closer, Tiny Dancer. Like,
okay, why do you want to ruin songs for me? why do you do
I'm
this?
I'm sorry. The second I heard that chorus, I was kind of like, oh, this is kind of like Tiny Dancer.
God, get out of here.
But
okay.
It's not a bad, like, Tiny Dancer is actually, I'm not a huge Elton John fan at all, but Tiny Dancer is actually, I think, one of my, like, the one song of his that I do actually like. So.
See, Tiny Dancer is one of those songs where it's all about the chorus. Like, I can't tell you how the rest of the song goes, top of my head.
Yeah, and that is the chorus of the Tiny Dancer, is that part.
But it's like a 5-minute song.
I'm not, yeah, and that's the only part of the song that reminds me of this song, is what I'm saying. Or I guess the other way around, since Tiny Dancer came out first.
So, okay, we have two tracks left, and I want to know, too, what you think about this run as far as the flow, as well as just the songs. Because you mentioned Ride the Cliché, bouncing out of Adhesive really well, which I agree. So then we get to this next song, and...
So I guess let's talk about these two songs, and then I'll kind of talk about the flow for the second half.
Okay.
Because there is a little bit, and I think this is why I try to come up with an alternative track listing, because you go from like, hold on, let me look at the song order. Like, Lady Picture Show, I guess I'm going to talk about track list, the flow now, even though I said I wasn't. Like, Lady Picture Show is kind of like a mid-tempo rock song, kind of like an old school rock song. Cool. Then you get kind of, not slower, but you definitely get, you know, vibier and more stripped back with And So I Know. But then you get really rock and aggressive with Trippin'. And the good thing is, even though Art School Girl is not a great song, it keeps similar energy. It's kind of a mix between And So I Know and Trippin', where it has a rock part in the chorus, but then it has like the kind of more dorky guitar riff in the verse, right? But then, yeah, Adhesive kind of, it sucks out any of the fun that the album had, but not in a bad way, in a good way. And then I like Ride the Cliché because it starts off with an abrasive riff that you think the song's going to go somewhere else, but then it becomes more like it's more like an Interstate Love song than it is a regeneration. And then you kind of do go back into like, okay, now we're doing another really artsy song, because Daisy, the next song, another instrumental, somewhat of a short song. It is like this, like, kind of like, I don't know what, like, is it a 60s kind of sounding song or 50s? Like, it has like, what's the genre of music it sounds like? It's not like a waltz. It's not like a cowboy. I don't know how, there's like a certain song that this song sounds like.
I do know that because it's a Robert track. I know he's really into like a lot of like bossa nova Latin-y type stuff. So I could kind of see something maybe like that. I'm not well versed enough to really assess it, but it does have a very particular sound, like, or you could imagine hearing it from like an old radio or something.
Yeah. And I'll say I dug it. Like, yeah, it's a little jazzy, which is cool. It kind of sounds like something like, not the song itself, but like it sounds like something Jack White would do on an album. Like, out of nowhere, he would pull this like short acoustic jazzy song, you know, like, so I like that, and it fits this album. Like, does this album need the song? No, it's not as important to this album as like Press Play, in my opinion, and I like it less than Press Play.
Really,
it's probably technically my like second, like this is the one where like if someone said it's their least favorite, I get it, because it's like definitely not like a full real song, and it is more repetitive than Tumble in the Rough, you know, because it's just a short little song, you know, but like it has the kind of cool like slides in the song, and
like it has the solid melody, a solid progression. Yeah. So it's a real song, like where you could argue Press Play is more just like a little jam section teaser.
Yeah. But that one I think is more important to the song. Like, you could go without Daisy, but I wouldn't take it off the album, and I do like it. So, it is a good song. I do enjoy it. And I guess it's as the penultimate track.
I think it does set you up. I think it is important.
It's, I don't know. It's not, to me, it's not like a penultimate track, like that type of song. You know, it's just only because, okay, I'll say this. If Adhesive, if let's say it went Ride the Cliché and then Adhesive, you would need something between Adhesive and the closing track. But I feel like you could have gone from Ride the Cliché to the closing track. Now, the only difference is, I do think my only issue with Ride the Cliché and with the closing track, which is Seven Cage Tigers, is, as I just realized, I haven't been saying the name at all, is that they're kind of similar in vibe a little bit.
Ride the Cliché and the closing track?
Yeah, like they're a little bit like, not the feeling of the song, but like, I don't know, like they're, I really like both songs because they don't seem like the obvious rocker on the album, like Pop, Love, Suicide, or Big Bang Baby, right? They're a little bit more melodic, and they kind of seem hopeful, even if they're not supposed to be, if that makes sense. And I'll just, I might as well, we might as well just finish up with Seven Cage Tigers. Like, this one was a weird one for me because I think it's a song that's still growing on me. I would put it more in the middle, though, than the bottom half. Like, I like it more than Art School Girl, or and I like it more than Daisy. I like it more than Tumble in the Rough. But it's one that I appreciate more with each listen because, first of all, when I first, the song first started, it's kind of interesting because the verse, it's kind of one of those songs where you can't tell the mood of the song. Like, some of it sounds optimistic. Some of it sounds like it's kind of got like a nice groove, but parts of like the bass line kind of sounds dark, if that makes sense. Like, it was kind of hard for me to get a reading on the song. And then when you get to the chorus, and this is a question, a legit question I have, is there a key change when it comes to the chorus?
Yes. So what is interesting about the whole song, like the progression wise, is that it definitely bounces around. There's a lot of different chords, and the tonality is kind of weird. Like you're saying, it's kind of hard to tell what it's going for. And even the, like, the measures of it, it kind of loops funny. Like, when the vocals start, when the song starts, you think that's the beginning of the chord progression, right? Yeah. But then the vocals come in on a different part, and you're like, oh, so yeah, that's the beginning of the chord progression. And then when you get to the chorus, it's a total key change and a bit of a rhythm change, too. Yeah, so, yeah, you're right. There's a lot going on with the
keys. But, like, once you get to the chorus, to me, it really starts becoming more optimistic. And just the music. And not even talking about the lyrics. Like, it just, I don't know, maybe because in my head, I'm like, this is a key change. Usually when there's a key change, I think in most songs, the key change for me is, like, it's supposed to, sometimes it's meant to be more dramatic. But sometimes I think it's, like, intentionally supposed to make the song kind of rise up. And it, to me, that's what the song does. It makes it more like positive sounding. And I think the part that's still like, I'm still kind of getting used to is that, like, this song, because of the sound, I thought the lyrics would hit really hard. And to me, out of all the songs on this album where he's made the comments about it, this is his Bowie, like, stream of consciousness, like, songwriting. That's what this song is to me. And maybe I'm missing a ton of metaphors or whatever. And I do think in the chorus, there's definitely a metaphor with Seven Cage Tigers fly by. Like, someone wrote online, they're like, oh, so the rumor is he wrote this song when he was high. And, like, he had an, like, what is it? Like a mirage, like a, he saw something that wasn't there. Like, he saw,
like, these, hallucination
of, like, these seven cage tigers, right? And, like, the verses, like, I just, like, I don't know, there's some lines that kind of make sense, and then there's other lines that don't make sense. So I think I was a little let down that, like, the lyrics didn't hit as hard for me, especially because the music does. Like, the music actually, the song ends on a note that I like. I like that the last song on this album is, like, all over the place. Like, I like that it kind of seems like it ends on a happy note. And actually, I might as well just say now, when the song, it comes to the last chorus, it ends on a minor chord, or it ends on one of those kind of funky chords. And I was, like, disappointed. I'm like, no, resolve it. Why do you end it there? But then I looked at my phone and I was like, there's, like, 30 more seconds of the song. What the heck? And then you hear the, like, really faint, reverby chords of, I think it's the chorus or the verse? The verse, I think.
The verse.
And I'm like, oh, that is a perfect way to end the song. I'm like, okay. If they hadn't done that, this song would have bumped down to, like, half a letter grade for me. But, like, that was smart, because I'm like, no, end it on a positive note. And then they did, because they went back into the, yeah. So I really like the ending, but I, for a minute there, I almost hated the ending.
The ending does end up being like perfect.
Yeah. And I really, again, this is one of those songs where Scott's vocals are very clean, and I really like it. It's in his sweet spot in his vocals. Not impressive, but really clean sounding, and it fits the song. And yeah, the song, like, it has like feelings of clean and uplifting to me, but it's definitely not as apparent as other songs on this album or other albums. But I'll say this, even just from that first like 30 seconds of the song, I'm like, I'm so glad we're not ending on another Long Way Home, because I dislike that song as a closer and as a song itself. And even if this is a song that I'm still kind of, it's growing on me, I was like, this is a much better closer than that song on that album.
Well, I will say both of these, the, both of those closers end with epic guitar work. This one is just chords, but the production and the performance is fantastic.
There's a
Long
good
Way Home is like a face melter solo.
Yeah, but this one has a good solo too. It's just a little bit more kind of standard rock solo, you know. It's not a melter.
It does follow the progression, which is cool, because it does get a little Beatles key change.
Yeah.
But now, if I will, I know we got to wrap this up here, but this song, I have so much yet nothing to say about it. This song still, I have no idea how I feel about it. And a little story here. This song technically got me into STP. You'll see where I'm going. I was watching bass covers of Ben Folds 5, Whatever and Ever, Amen. Selfless, Cold, and Composed, I think, was the one. And this guy on YouTube, bass guitar, it's like bass guitar 4020 or something like that. He covered this song acoustically, as well as the Bipolar Bear solo.
Is that a bass acoustic cover or acoustic guitar?
Acoustic guitar.
Oh, okay.
And he sang it and stuff. And I'm like, Ben Folds 5, STP, that seems kind of like a weird combo. I don't know STP. And, you know, Bipolar Bear is one of my favorite songs of the band. And definitely checking out this in the album, I was like, okay, this song's kind of interesting. Like, there's cool chords in it and stuff. And I just don't know how I feel about it, because this song has, in the vocal performance, it has the vulnerability of Adhesive to an extent.
It, his vocal performance, really quick, not to interrupt, reminds me a little bit of Elliott Smith.
Oh.
Which Elliott Smith, to me, has a very vulnerable vocal performance in most songs.
And this is the second time you say Scott reminds you of Elliott, which is interesting, on a Too Cool Queenie. Different vibe, but...
Yeah.
And the lyrics, too. The lyrics are like, I get upset that the lyrics are so throwaway, but imagine this scene. Like, you can tell I spent a long time with this album. Here's what I kind of imagine. You take this album, we talked about stardom and drug abuse and everything, and there's some hopeful moments, like in Tumble in the Rough, termination at the beginning, absolute downfall in Adhesive. And you get this song where he's talking about passing time, by a minute, spend an hour burning, the answer gets harder and the truth's getting farther. Seven caged tigers fly by, 7 days a week. You know, watching time goes by. Track the blade as it sweeps downward and onward. Once again, passing time. Hike a mile as it keeps crawling. It just feels like this whole song, he is living this routine of meaningless.
Well,
drinking, abuse. The answer gets hard and it just flies by. And the song does fly by. It just feels unsettled, unresolved. But in this morbid thought, at the end, it almost just feels like this routine that doesn't resolve. Once the ending just feels like heavenly, like it just feels like,
yeah, those last like 20 seconds, yeah,
right, those last ones, it just feels like life has passed and there's some sort of peace. And it's just, I don't know.
Well, again, I know this isn't a concept album, but the more I listen to this album, the more I get the concept of this is his take on society's take on rock star and pop stars. And maybe I was thinking like he feels like a caged tiger. I don't know where the seven comes from, like why there's seven caged tigers, but my thought process was that he feels like a caged tiger sometimes. And which would go with what you're saying, like he feels like he's bound to routines and obligations and whatnot, responsibilities. Maybe that's part of why he, you know, he used drugs. And so, yeah, it does have this sense of like, you can't tell if this is like a positive song for him or if this is a little bit more of like a darker song. And that's kind of why I like that the music is like the verse, it's a little bit more darker, mysterious, and then the chorus is a little bit more uplifting.
I mean, I don't know. I think the whole thing is, I don't think it's really positive at all. I think the only thing that is maybe positive or hopeful about it is that it will end. And he doesn't even really say that. It's just what I'm picking up. Now, I think the song's very up to interpretation.
Well, and I'm usually an optimistic person. So maybe, like, for me, when the chorus, when he sings the answers get harder, maybe this song seems hopeful because he's finally understanding why things are like this. Because sometimes that's like where you have to start. You have to acknowledge the problem before you can solve it.
Right. And with the key change too, it does really, it's showing enlightenment.
The key change really, that's what makes the song kind of more hopeful to me than like a downer.
You know, okay. I agree with what you're saying, but when the chorus hits, it's unsettling to me. Just like where they go musically and the vocal melody and how it hits, it just feels so jagged. Like it does not sound super pleasing almost. Like it almost sounds dissonant, the change.
Well, and that's why I'm a little surprised that this isn't, I thought this was going to be like in your top two or three, mainly because when we were chatting about what song you were going to cover for this episode, this was like the first one you said, which it made me think like, this is why this is like your favorite. So I'm actually kind of surprised that this is not, you kind of feel a little similar to me in sense of like where you would rank it on the album.
Like, I think emotionally on the album, it is so, in general, I think it's an emotionally unique song, and the vulnerability and the kind of the lack of grounding makes it a really unique experience that I like and I want to like. But as a song, it does kind of lack. It's not very well supported. But I think I like that about it. This album, some of the best moments are kind of the unhinged things.
Well, and I'll take the song any day over Long Way Home.
I do like it. I would maybe put it top five, but it's definitely one that I can't put my finger on why I like it or where I think it should be as a song. Like,
yeah, I agree. And, you know, I don't really think I need to. I mean, I will a little bit, but I don't think I need to really sum up my feelings too much. I was shocked and surprised by how much I liked this album. I was just surprised by, especially because when you read the Wikipedia article, they started off with like, oh, first the band scrapped 2 weeks worth of recording time they spent in the studio because like right after Scott got busted for having drugs, you know? So like, and then like the fact that they had started that side band and like, I don't know, like when you read the Wikipedia article, you don't assume that the end product is going to be as great as it is or was. And I've seen people online say that this is their favorite, but then you do have a couple fans where they say this is their least favorite. And I could see where those fans are coming from because like, if your favorite is Core Purple, I could probably see why this is like your least favorite, which is probably why when I listen to all their records, this would probably end up being my favorite, and like Core might be my least favorite. Like, I wouldn't be shocked, you know, if it was something.
This record
like
just seems a lot quirkier than something you would normally listen to.
But no, but it's more melodic. It's over the years, I've really grown a soft spot for like pop music done right. And I'm not calling this album pop because it's not. But like, again, like with the other STP album you gave me, Days of the Week, like that's such a poppy,
fun song.
And I think on this album, you get moments that are not straight ahead rock. You get bossa nova, you get jazz, you get lounge music. Like, and yeah, I don't listen to a whole album worth of those genres, but some of my favorite albums from my favorite bands, like Pearl Jam, like Yield, like that to me is where they can maintain their rock appeal by throwing in a little bit of experimental, a little melodic, a little weirdness. And I think this is the album for this band that this is their album that does that. And I just think the songwriting like is at like their best just from the songs I've heard from them. And like, Yeah, because this album, like, imagine if, like, they had swapped out, like, Tumble in the Rough or Big Bang Baby for a song like Interstate Love Song. This album would be just, like, unstoppable. So I'm not, this album isn't perfect because there's some songs and even some of the hits that I don't love as much from this album. But, like, the moments on this album where the band takes the risk, I think it's so well paid off.
I think it's a very unique record. Nonetheless.
Yeah. And yeah, I just, it's, and it's an album. It's one of the albums where I'm actually going to, like, there's going to be days where I'm in the mood for this album and only this album, and I'll go put it on. And I actually think I am going to spend money and get that, you know, and again, I don't need the vinyl version to have all the bonus stuff. I just want the album. But fortunately right now,
I'm
like
thinking about it too. I'm thinking about it too, because I don't have every STP record, but I have most of them now. I don't have Core, but I'm not a huge Core fan even, so it's not on my priority.
I should go to Target. Every time I'm at Target, I see Core and Purple.
Yeah, I got Purple. Unfortunately, I don't have it on Purple vinyl, but my pressing sounds great. That's all that matters.
Actually, the worst part of this album for me is the album cover. I hate the album cover. And I read that, like, after they, like, figured out what the album cover was going to be, that shrine in the background, Scott was like, oh, I want this on the album cover, because he actually has something like this at his house at the time, which is like a cool story. But I just hate, like, it looks so, the whole album cover looks cheesy. It looks like it's like should be in like in a Sims video game. Like, I don't love it, and I hate that on Spotify the little graphic is like the really like weirdly photoshopped like crocodile or alligator. Like, I don't know. And I don't love the album title either. I mean, Tiny Music is fine, but I don't love the whole Vatican gift. Like, I don't know. Like, the album cover and title, that to me is too quirky. I understand right. It fits the music, but the music is so much better than the quirkiness of the cover or the title.
If Tiny Music wasn't such a perfect shortening for an album cover or an album title, yeah, that would have probably honestly like impacted a bit. And I will say, watch the Big Bang Baby
oh,
video.
Yeah, I will.
And I think it kind of helps with like the lady. Like, it kind of fits this cheesy kind of vibe. And I think it kind of goes tongue in cheek with the whole like stardom thing. But yeah, the freaking shrine in the background just really kills it. The crocodile would have been passable, but the shrine just looks terrible on top of it.
But I will say, you knocked it out of the park with this suggestion for this month. Again, our goal is not to just give each other an album that we think is going to become a favorite of theirs. Like, we're gonna, and especially next month, we've been talking about what we're gonna give each other, and we won't say it on this episode yet because we're still deciding. But eventually down the road, we're gonna give each other albums that we think will challenge the other person. And maybe you thought this was going to be a challenge, but for me, this was like just a home run. This was just like, I really like the sound of this album. So this might be my favorite. I think it might beat Light Grenades for me. And yeah, right now this is kind of like my Darkness on the Edge of Town. So
there we go. I know you've given me Darkness and Recovering the Satellites fully, completely. Even I would probably say like albums that really, really impressed me.
Yeah. And this was it. So. We have now gone about 2.5 hours long.
Apologies.
Yeah, listeners, I'm sure only the diehard STP fans and our mom and grandmother are the only ones who are listening still at this point. But we appreciate it if you stuck around this long. Definitely let us know your thoughts on this album. Let us know like specific thoughts on like, where do you stand with Seven Cage Tigers? Because there's some songs in here where I would love to hear other people's interpretations. So drop us a comment. And we have some fun videos coming up the next couple of weeks. So stay tuned for those. And until then, we hope you take care. And you'll be hearing from us soon. Bye-bye.